Good afternoon. The next first item of business is a debate on motion 4534 in the name of Graeme Dey on behalf of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee on reports on draft climate change plan, the draft third report and policies and proposals. Can I ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now? Time is tight, I say this at the start, so I call on Graeme Dey to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. 6 minutes, please, Mr Dey.
Presiding Officer, let me begin by saying how privileged I feel to be opening a debate of this importance as the convener of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. It's a privilege, I think, for all of us to be able to contribute through the scrutiny process in some meaningful way to producing a final plan that we can all have confidence will deliver Scotland's emissions targets. And the role that today's point in that process represents was, I think, summed up by a comment from Friends of the Earth in the covering note for their briefing for this debate, where it stated, "This is an important opportunity to reflect upon the undoubted strengths of the draft plan and to take forward the improvements to the draft that could turn it into a truly credible and ambitious blueprint for a low-carbon Scotland." My role in this debate, as will be the case with the conveners of the other committees that had scrutinised the plan, will be to lay out the principal findings and recommendations of our unanimously agreed report. I look forward to hearing committee members expanded upon this in the course of the afternoon and hearing the thoughts of other committees. The process undertaken by the Environment Committee has produced a number of clear recommendations for improving the draft plan. And given that the government aided the scrutiny process by delaying publication of the draft to maximise the time available to committees, and the Cabinet Secretary for the Environment is on record as saying she will not only engage further and deeper with stakeholders, but carefully consider the best time to finalise the plan to ensure the views of the whole of the parliamentary scrutiny process can be taken on board, then we look forward to our views being given appropriate consideration. We're also looking for the government to seek advice from the UK CCC in moving to the final iteration of the plan. Let me reflect further on the overall thinking of the committee and identify some of the specific areas where we believe changes are required. The committee are concerned that the method of development of the carbon envelopes was inconsistent. A number of sectors, transport, agriculture, waste and land use, were modelled out with the Times framework. The Times model also does not consider wider benefits, and the draft plan is unclear on the extent to which abatement potential has influenced the inclusion of policies. While broadly welcoming the principle of a whole system approach, the committee do not consider the Times model and the development of the carbon envelopes to have been sufficiently structured, formalised or consistent to deliver us. There's a lack of clarity and transparency in the draft plan around the information that was fed into and produced by the Times model, which has meant that the members were constrained in their ability to fully scrutinise and express confidence in the policies and proposals which have been advocated. It's the view of the committee that agriculture and transport, the sectors which have made least progress in cutting emissions, are not being asked to make the significant leaps anticipated by the UK CCC and stakeholders. We believe the emission reductions required of each sector should be equally challenging. It's our view that this is not the case with two. Therefore, the committee recommends the Scottish Government revise the carbon envelopes for transport and agriculture to show greater ambition. Although a monitoring and evaluation framework is described in the draft plan, the committee do not consider the suite of policies and proposals as currently presented are, given the lack of accompanying detail and data, capable of smart analysis, and propose that the Scottish Government should include further specific and consistent information across all policies and proposals in the final plan to ensure there is clarity in the pathways to delivery. That would increase confidence in the robustness and achievability of the plan and lay a clear way forward for committees to scrutinise progress made through the intended annual updates on progress, an approach the committee very much welcomes. It would be our hope that all relevant successor committees would see it as part of their work programme to look at these update reports on an annual basis. And in terms of the future, the committee, whilst recognising the impact of the electoral cycle, believes the Scottish Government should be mindful not to be running in tandem consultations on strategy which impact on RPPs because of the difficulty created in determining how these ultimately might impact the plan. In this instance, it was unavoidable that the consultation of the draft energy strategy was taking place in parallel, but it's not ideal. And we would look for the final RPP3 to say explicitly how the results of the draft energy strategy consultation have contributed to the plan and clarify the relationship between the plan and all other relevant national strategies. The committee further considered that it's unclear in the plan whether assumptions such as the development and implementation of CCS are supported by alternatives, should the assumptions which have been made prove to have been overly optimistic. It's our view the final plan should, through remodelling, set out an alternative plan B. The committee also believe the final climate change plan should be accompanied by information on the output of an additional Times Model run, which emphasises alternative car traffic growth assumptions and with a greater emphasis on modal shift. Although behaviour change has been considered and included in the draft plan, its application in policies and proposals is omitted or inconsistent. This should be addressed in the final plan. Unfortunately, it was only after the committee had agreed its report that it finally secured clarity of the position being taken around soil testing and how the government intended taking this strand of the plan forward. The committee's view is that soil testing of improved land only must be compulsory and the plan should be amended to reflect this. However, compulsory testing should be introduced in a phased way and supported by the availability of guidance and advice, not only in relation to testing, but how the information gleaned should then be deployed. Soil testing in itself will not deliver a contribution to tackle climate change. It's how the results are then deployed which has that potential. Having dealt with the land, let me turn to the sea briefly, Presiding Officer, and highlight a further call from the committee asking that the final climate change plan contains policies and proposals on blue carbon. Finally, Presiding Officer, the committee notes it has been the practice to present the final plan prior to the summer recess of the parliamentary year. However, given the issues identified by the stakeholders in the various committees, we concur with the Cabinet Secretary for the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform that the priority should be consideration of matters raised by the scrutiny process rather than any immediate deadline, and we commit to working with the government to ensure the plan realises its potential. Presiding Officer.
Please move the motion for the committee. Mr Dey, please move the motion for the committee. I don't think you moved.
Apologies, I move the motion.
Thank you. I call Gordon Lyndhurst to speak on behalf of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. Mr Lyndhurst, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The whole world is waking up to climate change and the impact on the way we live our lives in the future. It is not only the environment that is at risk if we do not face up to this, but the world economy as we know it. Some of the most promising growth markets across the globe are grappling with the fact that they are some of the most at risk when it comes to the consequences of global warming. They could literally see profits washed away by the forces of nature if action is not taken, not at the moment, sorry. Climate change increasingly poses one of the biggest long-term threats to investments and the wealth of the global economy. That was the view of Cristiana Figueres, at the time Executive Secretary of the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, instrumental in forming the Paris Climate Agreement. And so it is that the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee is taking part in this debate today. In fact, many aspects of the draft climate change plan are within that committee's remit, which, given that the remit also includes energy, covers quite a lot of ground, which I cannot hope to address in a few minutes here today. But I want to touch on a few issues the committee considered, including transparency, timescale, and behaviour change. We welcome the whole system approach of the Times model. However, this cannot be at the expense of the level of detail included in previous climate plans. Don't just take our word for it, Deputy Presiding Officer, we defer to the authority of the Stern Review of the Economics of Climate Change, which encouraged caution and humility in all modelling, reminding us that results are always specific to the model and its assumptions. The evidence that we heard was that even a whole system offers only a partial insight. So ambition should not be confused with wishful thinking, and a snazzier title is one thing, but the information fed into the model has not been proffered, nor the weighting afforded to delivery, costs, and disruption. The plan should detail budgets, targets, and timelines, as well as policies, not only for our benefit, but for those tasked with delivery of the plan. What would be helpful to know is the inputs for certain sectors and how they were formulated. Lesser targets for some put pressure on others, such as electricity, services, and housing. Told to cut emissions by 120%, 96%, and 76% respectively, whilst transport and agriculture are asked for 31% and 12%, yet together, these two produce 28% of all greenhouse gas emissions. So suffice to say that the Scottish Government has not shown its workings, and neither has it given much of a clue as to the content of Scotland's energy efficiency programme, which is called SEEP by its friends. It is said to be key to ministerial thinking on climate change, but much of the plan's success to, quote, stop climate chaos Scotland relies on a programme which does not yet exist. One wonders, Deputy Presiding Officer, do androids dream of an energy efficiency future? This is something the committee will return to in our scrutiny of the draft energy strategy. SEEP, that is, not the androids, at least not yet. Timescale is my next theme. The Stern Review said that climate change was the greatest and widest-ranging market failure ever seen, that delay would be costly and dangerous. The committee in this regard supports the move towards low carbon heat. Pace of change is, however, what concerns us, with so little apparently happening before 2025. We do appreciate that technologies are evolving, but transforming our housing stock and the public and commercial sectors all in 7 years. Surely more can be done to front-load some of that work. My final theme is behaviour change. Not altering, not attuning, not adjusting, but major non-marginal change in how we consume energy. Again, I'm afraid we found detail in short supply. Scottish Renewables underscored the need for buy-in of support from individuals and institutions alike. It is unclear, they said, how we achieve that without clear and concise messages. The final plan must deliver those messages. Governments can be a catalyst for dialogue through evidence, education, persuasion, and discussion. Again, that is what the Stern Review said, this time more than a decade ago. So I want to end where I began. Our economies and the necessities of life are under threat. Access to water, production of food, the very air that we breathe. The next chapter of the story is for us to write, but write it we must.
Thank you, Mr. Lyndhurst. I call on Bob Dorris to speak on behalf of the Local Government and Communities Committee. Mr. Dorris, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to talk on behalf of the Local Government and Communities Committee on the draft climate change plan. The focus of our scrutiny was in local government and communities, of course, as you would expect, planning and the residential sector. I also want to pay tribute to the work of fellow committees who scrutinised the plan also. Together, we've ensured proper scrutiny of this important plan to help Scotland reach its world-leading climate change targets despite a very challenging 60-day timetable. And in relation to that, can I also thank the clerking team from my committee presiding officer, as well as all those that gave written and oral evidence to our committee. It is a challenging time for local government, given competing priorities. We highlight that the Scottish Government must work with councils to ensure that they are properly resourced to develop climate change leadership. It should also support local government to embed climate change considerations into procurement procedures and practices. There's clearly significant opportunity there. From the community sector, we heard concerns that there was a lack of focus on how communities and community empowerment agenda could contribute to climate change abatement. We also felt there should be more of an emphasis on how the Scottish Government will drive behaviour change in those communities where climate change is a lower priority, yet another opportunity. Both these issues should be addressed in the final version of the plan. The plan recognises the vital contribution that the spatial planning process can play in climate change abatement. However, there was a lack of information on specific policies in relation to how the planning sector would contribute to targets. This made it slightly difficult to scrutinise the government's plans in relation to planning. However, we note that further detail will be brought forward following the Scottish Government's consultation on the planning process. We highlight that the Scottish Government should consider strengthening the final version of the plan to show how it will use the planning system to encourage more active and sustainable modes of travel, protect green space land, directing development instead onto brownfield sites. On a more general point, Presiding Officer, we were concerned to hear of resourcing issues within the planning system. We have asked for further information on how the Scottish Government will work with local authorities to ensure planners and key decision makers have the right skill set to ensure that climate change impact is properly considered in all decisions relating to planning. In terms of the residential sector, we welcome the ambitious targets for the sector, although again, many of the policies and proposals in relation to the residential sector are still out for consultation, making it difficult for us to scrutinise plans for the sector in any great detail. This includes the Scottish Energy Efficiency Plan, which will underpin most of the measures within the housing sector. Its consultation is due to close in spring, alongside consultations on the draft energy strategy and regulation of district heating. Given their importance to Scotland meeting its targets, it was disappointing that these were not consulted on and finalised for the publication of the plan itself. However, we have requested that these strategic documents are linked strategically across future iterations of the said plan. We also heard evidence on the accuracy and consistency of the EPC rating system. However, we are aware that the Scottish Government alongside the UK Government are reviewing the process and would expect to receive regular updates within that area also. One of the major issues raised was the slow progress in transferring regulation in the private residential sector from a proposal to a policy since the last climate change plan. The Minister has confirmed to us that it will begin a consultation on the regulation in the private rented sector this month and will bring forward a timescale for consulting in the owner-occupier sector when it launches. We welcome this commitment, but would like an explanation as to why progress has been slow. This leads to concerns around how the ambitious targets for decarbonisation of the household heating networks will be met. We heard how this will be largely reliant on changing technologies, decisions of the UK government and policies and procedures which will drive behaviour change and potentially regulatory measures also. Finally, we heard about successful the Scottish area-based approach to the Home Energy Efficiency Programme has been. It has been a success story. The programme has allowed local authorities to maximise its share of UK funding to install home external and internal wall insulation on a large-scale basis. Such measures are known to benefit health and assist in alleviating fuel poverty. So it was concerning to hear that some felt there was a lack of emphasis in this programme in the plan, particularly given the ambitious figures presented for installations going forward. We've asked the Minister for comments on how this programme would be funded and delivered post-2021. The ambitious targets highlight the Scottish Government's intention to be a world leader in reducing climate change, and this is to be welcomed. Our committee intends to play a substantial role in holding the Government to account for its performance, but of course also working in partnership with it, and we will continue to closely follow the Scottish Government's progress towards meeting targets in areas within its remit. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I call Edward Mountain to speak on behalf of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. Mr Mountain, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And before I go any further, I'd like to refer members to my register of interest. I'd like to start off by thanking everyone who gave evidence to the committee, and also to the committee and our clerks for all the hard work they did in the scrutiny of the plan. The Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee struggled to scrutinise the draft climate change plan within the 60 days that are allowed. We concluded that the time allowed was too short, and a minimum of 120 days would allow better and proper scrutiny. Given the tight timescales, we looked at three specific areas: agriculture, transport and forestry. And it's worth noting, as Mr Dey has already said, that these areas don't fall within the Times Energy model. And the emissions envelopes for agriculture, forestry and transport were developed separately and added to the model, which is far from ideal. This raises additional issues that there is, first of all, no baseline data or the details of specific emissions attributable to each policy. Secondly, there's a significant lack of financial information provided in the draft plan. And thirdly, that there's a lack of monitoring and evaluation framework and smart targets. Given the very shortness of the time that we have to debate this afternoon, I would like to look at some of the key findings in each area. First of all, agriculture. It contributes 23% of the total emissions and is the third largest contributor in Scotland. The committee heard that the agriculture is a difficult sector to decarbonise, which is why it has the lowest reduction target. Some said that it wasn't ambitious enough and lacked detail. We accepted as a committee, in order to achieve climate change targets, that the goodwill of farmers and land managers was and is important. We accepted also that much of the historical good works undertaken by farmers has not been acknowledged or quantified. Now, I'd like to pick up on one particular issue, which is soil fertility. Much is often made of nitrogen, phosphorus and potash use, but we heard also in the committee about the importance of soil structure and that needs long-term management and investment. The committee accepted the need to encourage all farmers to test the soils on improved land in rotation. We also heard that to ensure investment by tenant farmers, that they need to be compensated at WAGO for the extra work they put into keeping the soils in good condition. The committee believes that to ensure a positive contribution to climate change and also to increasing production, we need to take farmers with us. During this scrutiny, there was discussion whether soil testing should be voluntary or mandatory, and the committee agreed that voluntary measures were appropriate at this stage. Turning, if I may, to transport, it's the second largest contributor and accounts for 28% of Scotland's total emissions. The committee welcomed the Scottish Government's goal to be free from harmful tailpipe emissions by 2050. But the committee recognised that since 1990, progress in emission reductions from the transport sector had been largely offset by increases in demand. It therefore gives recommendation that further consideration is given to policies that will control demand and try and encourage a modal shift away from the use of private cars. The draft climate change plan focuses on ways in which technological developments will reduce transport emissions. This includes incentivising more rapid uptake of electric and ultra-low emission cars, enhancing the electric vehicle charging networks and the electrification of rail networks. Witnesses raised concern that the plan is overly reliant on the uptake of low emission vehicles, and there are a number of assumptions about technological improvements. For example, it is assumed that battery costs will reduce and that there will only be 27% traffic growth by 2030. The committee were not convinced these were right, and if they are not right, the transport targets are unlikely to be achieved. We also heard that there had been little progress made in relation to active travel, with Scottish transport statistics showing that in 2015, only 1% of journeys were by bike, which is well below the 2020 ambition of the government of 10%. This figure has remained stubbornly at the 1% figure since 2003. The committee believes that walking and cycling has an important contribution to make in reducing carbon emissions, and the government needs now to set out clearly how it intends to meet this target by 2020 that it has set itself. Now, turning, if I may, briefly to forestry. Approximately 1.44 million hectares of woodland in Scotland is in woodland. That is 18% of the total land area. This is less than the EU average of 40%. While 70% of this woodland is populated with conifers, which can be used for production, the remainder is in broadleaves. Progress since the last climate change plan in 2013 has been painfully slow, and the Scottish Government has failed to meet its forestry targets every year. Last year, for example, 4,500 hectares were planted against a target of 10,000 hectares. We heard some of these failures are attributable to the grant structure and the application process, and the committee heard that the McKinnon report may well streamline the forestry industry to help achieve these planting targets, and it hopes that this is the case. It will, after all, be up to the government to ensure that the targets are met. Now, there were other issues turning to timber and the right tree in the right place, but I'll leave that for people to read in the report. In conclusion, the committee looks forward to the government's response to our report and the points raised by us, and to see how they will feature in the final climate change plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. I call on Rosanna Cunningham to open for the government cabinet secretary. 8 minutes, please.
Can I thank the conveners and members of the four committees for all the work done in their scrutiny of the draft climate change plan? And I'd also like to thank all of those who provided evidence to the committees and helped them in their work. This is, of course, a draft plan to be turned into a final plan, and I will give an update on that progress before the summer recess, even albeit that the final plan itself won't come until later. The draft plan is building on strong foundations. The 2009 Act set a target of 42% emissions reductions by 2020. Instead, by 2014, emissions had already been reduced by 45.8%, meaning we have exceeded the original target 6 years early. This is second only to Sweden's record of success, and we should be immensely proud of that achievement. Neither should we forget it. However, we're not resting on our laurels. The draft plan sets out how we will continue to drive down emissions by the equivalent of 66% by 2032. We will, of course, be introducing a new climate change bill to raise that ambition even further in the light of the Paris Agreement. As well as maintaining our high ambition and preparing for increased ambition in the future, the draft plan builds on our success so far. I went through the contents of the plan in the Chamber 8 weeks ago, so I'm not going to attempt to do so again today. It is action on the ground that matters. With that in mind,
Mike. Mr. Rumbles.
I wonder if the Minister can tell us whether the government's proposed air passenger duty reduction will help when it's estimated that 60,000 tonnes of carbon extra will be pumped into the atmosphere.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it is built into the overall targets of the plan, and the question has been asked and answered so many times, I'm beginning to wonder if Mike Rumbles needs to see somebody about his hearing. I want to go back to action on the ground. Yesterday, I visited the Red Moss in Balerno to see an example of peatland restoration not far from Edinburgh. I also opened applications for the government's £8 million action fund that will help us deliver on the climate change plan's commitment to restore 250,000 hectares of peatlands by 2032. I'm glad to see that commitment being welcomed in the Environment, Climate Change, Land Reform Committee report. Turning to the committee reports in more detail, there was broad support expressed for the whole system approach that we took to developing the draft climate change plan. Now, that's important because the draft plan was developed using an approach that does differ from the previous two plans or reports on policies and proposals. I know that this model and our use of it has been a theme in at least one committee's scrutiny of the plan. In my view, using the Times model represents a significant step forward in the government's carbon planning. It has allowed us to get a real handle on the costs of emission reduction and for the first time allowed us to make consistent judgments about where best to focus our efforts. I think we may be the first government to use this internationally recognised modelling framework to develop a carbon plan in a live political setting. It has been a steep learning curve as we have worked through the plan's development, and the committees, of course, have been on the same learning curve. This new approach does differ from that used in the previous two reports, and that might be frustrating, particularly when the information produced by the modelling is different to before. This does not mean that the approach is wrong and that we should not persevere with it. Some committees have expressed concern. I'm sorry, I've got a minute less than I was originally told I had, so I must press on. Some committees have expressed concern about a lack of information on alternative scenarios in the draft plan. Looking even 15 years into the future is not easy, given the political and technological uncertainties we face. The reports contain a number of recommendations on including different scenarios in the final plan, and certainly some additional scenarios may be helpful. However, we would need to choose carefully to avoid turning the plan into a think tank report. Throughout the development of the plan, I've been clear that I envisaged that all sectors would play their part. That does not mean equal reductions across the board, but that we balance the relative costs of reduction in each sector against other benefits of the policies, such as improvements in health, as well as the need to take full advantage of the business opportunities offered by the plan and the economic importance of each sector. The carbon envelope for transport is a good case in point. Our judgment did differ from the Committee on Climate Change. Our approach has been developed using robust external research that has been published in full by Transport Scotland. The message of that research was that reducing emissions from transport is a long-term project. This is something that we have said since the publication of the original delivery plan in 2009. It is important to recognise that the demand for transport is shaped by the operation of the economy, by commerce rather than commuting. Accommodating this demand is an important plank in strengthening our economy, and that has been an important consideration in setting the transport envelope. Important though behaviour change is, it cannot offer anywhere near the same level of abatement as can advances in vehicle technology. It is our view that the emphasis on technology is correct. And that said, this government is committed to delivering our manifesto commitment on low emission zones for both their impact on emissions and their health benefits from improved air quality. We will also continue to explore other approaches to behaviour change. The draft plan sets out our plans to encourage a switch to active travel and public transport. Now, agriculture is another area where we have been encouraged to look again at our ambition. And we will consider this recommendation alongside all those made by the committees. However, the Rural Economy Committee's recognition that in order to achieve climate change targets, the goodwill of farmers and land managers must be ensured is something we cannot simply ignore. We do know that emissions from agriculture are more difficult to reduce than those in other sectors. This is because the vast bulk of these emissions are from biological sources fundamental to food production, and only a small proportion is a result of energy use. Now, we've touched upon technology already, and I would like to return to the wider issue of the reliance of the draft plan on what some people have called technical fixes. I think it is pretty obvious that a plan stretching 15 years forward and involving a number of decisions that will have infrastructure implications far longer lasting than a decade and a half can't avoid considering new technologies. I've already committed the government to seriously consider the recommendations on alternative technological scenarios as we develop the final plan. I will also consider how we can add more transparency to our plan by being explicit about when key decisions on infrastructure, such as the future of the gas network in Scotland, are anticipated. A similar approach can be taken to key milestones in the development of technologies such as carbon capture and storage, and at what stage we would need to activate fallback plans if milestones are missed. And it is obvious, and I will say it, that we do need a clear monitoring framework, and that I have committed to developing this and to reporting every year on progress. I've already told my officials to seek to agree a common approach with the Committee on Climate Change and to ensure that engagement continues. Our draft plan has given us a clear vision of the nature of the changes that will need to happen across Scotland to deliver our ambitious targets. We do now need to consider Parliament's recommendations, produce the final version of the plan, and most importantly, we all need to work together to reduce emissions.
Well done, Cabinet Secretary. You've been misinformed by timing, not by our office, I don't think. So I now move on to call Alexander Burnett, please, to open on behalf of the Conservatives. 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I agree that maybe the timing communications haven't been correctly sent out to us. Indeed, I will endeavour to be as on time. Before I start, I'd like to inform the Chamber of my register of interest, especially those in relation to renewable energy. With this being my first time through the process of a committee response to a government paper, I must say that I found the process most encouraging. The unanimity of the committees in their criticism of the Scottish Government's climate change plan has made for a refreshing change. However, according to the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee, the plan lacks transparency. I won't be taking any interventions since the time's been reduced. We don't know about it. According to our own Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee, it lacks credibility. According to the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, it lacks accountability. And according to the Local Government Committee, it places an over-reliance on technology. Now, we have seen where the Scottish Government want to go on climate change, and we support that ambition. But the lack of a credible plan on how we achieve that ambition is more than concerning. We are also supportive of the Times model used to inform that strategy, and we would agree that it is an excellent model. It is just unfortunate that the Scottish Government has chosen not to use it properly. With 50% of carbon coming from transport and agriculture, those two sectors were decided outside of the model, skewing the assessment on those sectors, and as a result, denigrating the model as a whole. We can only hope that in future uses of the model, these emissions will be corrected. Similarly, we look forward to the release of the model to universities, which will allow open source examination of the data inputs and outputs, something the committee repeatedly requested and deemed necessary to allow proper transparency of a strategy, a point also noted by Friends of the Earth. But the transparency of a strategy is not the only problem it suffers from. It is also clear, and supported by Transform Scotland, that the climate change strategy is too dependent on technology and factors beyond the Scottish Government's control. And when I put this to the Cabinet Secretary at committee a few weeks ago, she was dismissive and spoke of great advances in technology to save the plan. Now, this may be applicable when talking about mobile phones, but I would contend that such changes are not as easily made in large infrastructure projects, such as installing district heating, repurposing the gas grid, or insulating Scotland's hard-to-treat homes. This requirement for technological improvements does not inspire confidence and makes the strategy unreliable. Take, for example, the Scottish Government's emissions reduction pathway for residential property. The residential sector is estimated to account for 15% of Scotland's total emissions this year, and its share is growing. It is therefore vital that we get this right. The target, according to the strategy, aims to decrease emissions by 84% by 2032. However, that is backloaded, with only 16% of that target being sought in the first 8 years, leaving the remaining 84% to be achieved in the second half. A trajectory so tainted by its formation that one can only assume that its architects are not planning on being around for its inevitable failure. So it should come as no surprise, then, that Scottish Renewables have questioned the strategy regarding the target to supply 80% of domestic properties with low-carbon heat technologies in 2025. This is a leap going from 18% to 80% in just 8 years. Now, given that almost 80% of homes are currently supplied by mains gas, this will require a huge step change in delivery. Now, I initially thought that this ambition would be achieved through district heating, but the Cabinet Secretary the other week was more focused on repurposing the existing gas grid. Now, for those not familiar with what this will entail, it will mean substituting the current methane gas with hydrogen. Technically, both feasible and desirable. However, it will require huge volumes of hydrogen to be produced. Now, if that is to come from electrolysis and electricity from renewables, then that is neither clear nor currently economically efficient. If, however, it is to come from conventional gas from the North Sea, with the resulting carbon return using carbon capture and storage, then it places a heavy reliance on what is currently a developing technology. Now, far be it from me to be cynical about this approach, but I might hazard a guess that with the Scottish Government placing all of its target eggs in one basket, it will be no surprise to guess who will they blame for their failure. Now, furthermore, the Scottish Government has not matched the Scottish Conservatives' call for a transformational change in energy efficiency, failing to set a target of all homes reaching EPC Band C by the end of the next decade. And I feel it is only right to remind the Chamber of our own manifesto commitment to spend 10% of the capital budget on making homes energy efficient. This would have been a cumulative £1 billion over the course of a Parliament, whereas the Scottish Government's latest programme for government only commits £500 million over the next 4 years to its SEEP programme. But the EPC system is also in need of reform. It is clearly evident that the market has no confidence in the EPC system since its inception in 2009. We see the same house receiving three different EPC ratings, depending on who comes out to do it. And a tick sheet is not enough to establish whether or not a house has proper insulation or not. We should be using these EPC ratings as a springboard for green mortgages and encouraging investors to buy energy-efficient homes. No, I've already said I'm not going to take any interventions with the time allowed. We have also promised to support district heating schemes, and government has a responsibility to lead and not be led. And this strategy has no such plans. So how can we expect companies to invest in such schemes when the Scottish Government can't be bothered to deploy its system in its Victoria Quay buildings, a location prime for district heating? So from stakeholders to cross-party committees, it is clear that the Scottish Government has made massive assumptions on technological externalities over which they have no control. We simply cannot rely on someone to reinvent the wheel to hit our climate change targets. The majority of goals in this strategy are infested with backdated targets and biblical-like reductions coming decades away. We need a clearer plan. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Before I get any more signals from members, can I say that the open debate is 5 minutes. The revised timings were agreed at the Bureau on Tuesday and conveyed to business managers, including the business manager for Parliament. So there you go. And don't anybody else ask me how long they've got. Open 5 minutes. Claudia knows you've got 6 minutes. Claudia Beamish, would you open, please, for Labour?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to start by recognising the significance of this climate change plan, which builds on the work of all parties from the Climate Change Act leading through the first two reports and beyond this one to our new climate change bill. This debate is an essential contribution to the focusing of the collective mind of the Scottish Government on changes recommended in the four committee reports. Reporting directly to our Parliament is testament to the mainstreaming of climate change. Scottish Labour also recognises the robust advice and support given to our committee by the UK Committee on Climate Change. Our own committee's responsibility for scrutinising the governance and the future monitoring and evaluation of the plan is a weighty one, and I want to thank our clerks and Spice for fulfilling the challenging role of supporting us so effectively. I also want to thank all those who gave written submissions and contributed evidence sessions, which has helped the committee to hone our thoughts. However, if the final CCP is to be truly at the core of all policies and proposals across government, our committee recommendation that it states explicitly how the results of the draft energy strategy will contribute to the final plan must be acted on. There are synergies between the plan and the energy strategy, including my private member's bill to ban onshore fracking for climate change reasons. The jobs opportunities for renewables and energy efficiency and related manufacturing and the circular economy must be underpinned by a just transition for workers and communities. Also, the committee recommends that the Scottish Government make the relationship between the CCP and other strategies, such as the National Planning Framework, the Infrastructure Investment Plan, and the Land Use Strategy, more explicit. The committee does have some serious concerns and some unanswered questions about the Times model. Only a persistent questioning of the Scottish Government did it emerge that as much as 40, if not more, percent of the sectoral assessment wasn't done through this whole system model. We also stated, as our convener Graeme Dey highlighted, that there is a lack of clarity and transparency in the draft plan surrounding the information that was fed in and produced by the Times model. This has meant, indeed, that scrutiny has been challenging. And the committee recommends that the Scottish Government revise the carbon envelopes for transport and agriculture to show greater ambition, these being two of our heaviest emitters. Whatever policy is put in, the Times model, as I understand it, pushes out the costings for. And I ask the Cabinet Secretary to carefully consider whether social inclusion and the pathway, in her own words, to the most beneficial pathway for the people of Scotland has been adequately accounted for in the assessment of every sector. Transport is a stark example of this, where a techie approach has been fed in, the shift to low emissions vehicles and the arguments put forward for that, to tackle projected increases in road traffic of 27% by 2030. Why is there no complementary modelling assessing the costs of planning more infrastructure for walking and cycling with the associated support for behaviour change? This would produce healthy options and cut congestion, multi-benefits. While, of course, we need to shift to low-carbon vehicles for commercial reasons and the economy, we also need a modal shift to active travel, and I ask for a rethink on this by the Cabinet Secretary. Our committee also has a sectoral focus on land use, peatlands, marine issues, the public sector, and waste. Graeme Dey has emphasised the importance of peatlands to the picture, and we now have an understanding of this, which was developed since a marker in RPP1, through international and domestic approaches of research collaborations, leading to specific policies funded by the Scottish Government. This is in stark contrast to the failure to push forward on the contribution of blue carbon, which was in RPP2 and is quite shockingly omitted from this draft plan. On questioning, Scottish Government officials acknowledge this will be remedied in the final plan, and this is one of the committee recommendations. We stress also the importance of the circular economy. And in contrast to the REC committee, we also recommend a staged move to compulsory soil testing on improved land. This must be supported with clear criteria and advice to be incremental. It is a means to an end. I also highlight the importance of the REC committee calls for consideration of organic farming and strongly support this as a biological contribution. The contribution of the public sector is also vital. With mandatory reporting duties, leadership and peer support will be key, and the contribution already made by some of the sector is to be lauded. The letter from Stephen Hagen of COSLO to the Cabinet Secretary is most encouraging. Children now in primary one will be in their early 20s when the final policies and proposals for this plan are actioned. In conclusion, The vision we now create for the way forward will need regular checking against the development of technologies which have not even been invented yet. As these children move towards and settle down in adult life in an utterly changed world of work and leisure, the plan must prove to be just for our society here in Scotland. If they are to live in a Scotland where our communities are protected from flooding, with warm housing and good green surroundings and connectivity, there must be robust monitoring and evaluation. And this is a framework 8 years in the making. So I listen to what the Cabinet Secretary is saying on this, but it must be the foundation of policy making. And it is vital that there is clarity in the pathways to delivery as we go forward in our climate change plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Beamish. Open debates. Mark Ruskell, followed by Liam MacArthur. Mr. Ruskell, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking the clerks, Spice, witnesses and members of all the four committees who've contributed to this scrutiny. And I'm particularly proud to be associated with the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform report, crafted under the strong journalistic guidance of our convener. But I'm left with a sense of frustration, Presiding Officer, with this climate plan, because in many ways it's a plan which could join things up, break us out of silo thinking, and allowed shared action across government and society. But the lack of transparency about what individual policies will achieve in carbon reduction and the uncertainty about what steps are needed to deliver those policies means it feels disconnected from practical action. So while there is some welcome clarity about the contribution that forestry and peatland restoration will make, and what effort will be needed each year to achieve this, in other areas it's far more opaque. We had the comment in the committee from the Cabinet Secretary for Climate that we'll only know what carbon reductions electric vehicles, for example, will deliver when they're actually on the roads. But whether these are the best policy choices at this stage remains a mystery. Agriculture and transport were modelled outside of times, so they were fixed at the outset, while other sectors got plugged into the model to work through what was left and ended up in many cases with more challenging targets. Now, I'm not saying carbon targets should necessarily be equal across all sectors, but they must be equally challenging. And this is where we have some problems with the plan. Let me turn to agriculture. We were warned by the UK Climate Change Committee that agriculture could overtake energy as a carbon emitter. And a compulsory soil testing regime was recommended as a simple but effective action to lower fertiliser wastage. And I was promised by a Cabinet Secretary for Climate in this chamber that soil testing would be compulsory when this plan was launched, only then for our rural Cabinet Secretary to clarify that this was not the case. Now, the fear around this seems to be that this would be burdensome for farmers. And in the words of Fergus Ewing, we must not jeopardise the goodwill of the custodians of the countryside. But what exactly is the concern here? Because the cost of soil testing on a 5-year cycle is just 22 pence per hectare per year. 22 pence, what a bargain price for a stable climate. And when farmers are spending around £70 per hectare per year, I haven't got time, unfortunately, I've only got 5 minutes, unless I can get it back at the end. Can I? No. Okay. When farmers are spending...
30 seconds, if you want to let
Mr. Okay, I'll take an intervention, yeah.
Sorry, I mean, I absolutely understand the need for soil testing, and most farmers are actually doing soil testing, but the fact is it's about the soil structure and what you do with the soil testing. There's no point in forcing soil testing if you don't do anything with the results.
Mark Ruskell.
Exactly. It's a starting point. If we understand the structure and the quality of our soils, we can then take some action. And let me tell you about the type of action that we need, because farmers are spending around £70 per hectare per year on arable fertiliser. So delivering efficiency savings, we reckon that by tackling pH, we could get 20% efficiency savings, will save them money. Applying lime to meet a target pH would involve only the most basic invoice record keeping that any farmer could manage, as part of a regime of cross-compliance. So, you know, to be honest, this is fruit that's so low-hanging, it's rotting on the ground. We just need to get on and deliver it, I think, as any knowledgeable farmer in this chamber will know. Transport is another unequally challenging sector. We've heard
I'm sorry, why are you on your feet? Oh, it's a point of order. I didn't hear that. Yes, Mr. Mountain, let me hear it.
Presiding Officer, I don't mind being called a lot of things, but by inferring that I'm not a responsible farmer by what he said, I think is actually verging on being rude.
Would you care to modify it?
If I can get another 20 seconds, that'd be great.
No, you don't get another 20 seconds for modification.
The word I actually said was any knowledgeable farmer. And I would assume that the member is a knowledgeable farmer and therefore needs to engage with the debate. Now, let me come to transport. I assume we get any more interventions. It's another unequally challenging sector. And we've heard conflicting views on the assumption that our vehicle mileage will go up by over a quarter in the 2030s. The Minister for Transport says this is the worst-case scenario if we sit on our hands, while the Cabinet Secretary for Climate believes there will be less growth in passenger traffic, more growth in vans and lorries connected with the economy. What's lacking is the range of more optimistic scenarios from the Element Energy report that should be plugged into Times. And we know that these exist, Presiding Officer. What we do know is that the last prediction in the 2006 transport strategy prepared us for increased traffic levels of around a quarter that in reality ended up at only 5%. And I'm concerned that once again, we've got a predict and provide approach to accommodating phantom traffic growth rather than a clear focus on traffic reduction. The technological fix of electric cars has its place, and there's room for more ambition here, but EVs alone will not deliver transport justice, nor the safer, less congested streets that communities need. The toolbox of policies needed to get modal shift from workplace parking levies, walking cycling infrastructure, urban speed limit reduction, and the rollout of more local low emission zones and focus on increasing bus use are not explicit in this plan. So, Presiding Officer, my colleague Andy Whiteman will focus more on the energy sectors, but it's clear that there's still much more to do to produce a plan that's fit for a low-carbon future. And I would urge the Scottish Government to take time to consider recommendations carefully before submitting its final plan. Thank you.
Thank you. Call Ian MacArthur, followed by Emma Harper. Mr MacArthur, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start by declaring as interested someone in receipt of micro-renewables support? Last week, I got 4 minutes on biodiversity. This week, it's 5 minutes on climate change. It feels like environmental speed dating, which may make it difficult to take interventions, but by way of compensation, can I pay tribute to the work of all four committees and those who gave evidence to them for the diligence of their work and the seriousness of their recommendations. I think as all four conveners pointed out, they covered a wide range of policy areas, but there did seem to me to be a common theme to all, that the draft plan, and it is a draft plan, falls short. It falls short on ambition, on transparency, on credibility, and on measurability. And that seems to be the clear message from all four committees, as well as many of the stakeholders from whom they heard. I welcome the fact that Rosanna Cunningham has clarified that she will update Parliament ahead of the summer recess, but it is perhaps regrettable that we have very little time to cover collectively what is a fairly substantial piece of ground. And it will be a collective effort. And I'm sure the Chamber, the Scottish Liberal Democrats, will work with MSPs from all parties in keeping ministers' feet, if not to the fire, then at least to the biomass boiler. In the time available, can I briefly touch on a number of issues, but leave my colleague Mike Rumbles to deal with the transport aspects, save for mentioning yet again, I think, the need for greater ambition to accelerate the take-up of electric vehicles, including continued improvements to the charging network. In relation to heat, which accounts for over 50% of our energy use, I don't think the government in any way can be accused of a lack of ambition, quite the reverse. Their targets for domestic and non-domestic properties by 2032 are pretty staggering. I think the question that's been raised is how credible they are, particularly with so precious little action being estimated pre-2025. I think it's a point that the Economy Committee very fairly picked up and asked to be addressed, perhaps by more front-loading. And I think the committee was right, too, that off-gas grid properties and district heating schemes should be priority action areas. Turning to electricity, where I think the government, following on from the previous coalition government, has made good progress to date. But I think there are legitimate concerns raised about how aspirations for negative emissions are going to be reached. And I share the desire of many in this chamber to see CCS fulfil its potential. But is it really sensible for the Scottish Government to appear to bet the house on its deployment in time to meet 2027 targets? Turning to energy efficiency, WWF has stated, and I quote, "The draft plan does not put forward credible policies and resources to deliver even the inadequate scale of intervention proposed and is certainly insufficient to support the transformational change suggested by its designation as a national infrastructure priority." And I think this found a bit of an echo in what the Economy Committee had to say as well. We do need detailed timescales for achieving minimum standards, including for the private rented sector and both domestic and non-domestic properties. Finally, and very briefly, may I address some comments to the area of agriculture, which along with transport was the subject of quite a bit of attention and criticism. And I think the lack of ambition there has been noted. I listened to the exchanges there between Edward Mountain and Mark Ruskell, and I think there is a difficulty in an environment where the future of support systems is up in the air. There's no great uncertainty. The proposal to come forward with compulsory measures is tricky, but I think there is evidence that these can secure benefits for farmers as well as for the environment. So I think there's a legitimate debate to be had here, even if it is around suitable times for implementation of something on a compulsory level. The NFU themselves, and realise this is from a different perspective, but they acknowledge that to reduce emissions is to reduce waste and improve efficiency. So I think we see a willingness there to engage with the issues in this draft plan, and I would hope that further improvements can be made. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm conscious that I've done nothing like justice to the work carried out by this Parliament's four committees in such an important issue. However, I thank them again for highlighting where the Government's draft climate change plan does come up short on ambition, on credibility, on transparency. Ministers need to show more green backbone. Scottish Liberal Democrats, working with others, are committed to ensuring they do, and that the final plan agreed by this Parliament does indeed do justice to the challenges we face in relation to climate change. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms McArthur. Emma Harper to be followed by Finlay Carson. Ms Harper, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to remind Chamber that I am the Parliamentary Liaison Officer to the CABSEC for Rural Economy and Connectivity. And I'd like to thank my colleagues on all the committees and the committee clerks who have all worked extremely hard to write this report on the draft climate change plan. Scotland's actions on climate change to date are amongst the most ambitious in the world, and the committee has welcomed the government's continued commitment to tackling climate change. The draft climate change plan sets out how the Scottish government plans to play its part in delivering the historic Paris Agreement. And my colleagues have already and will continue to outline that there are many elements to the plan, and one of the most significant being agriculture, which I'll come back to. Enabling community action on climate change is also a welcome focus. In Dumfries and Galloway, there are already a lot of enthusiasm for finding inventive ways of dealing with climate change at a local level. Last year, Scottish Government money was awarded to the Reuse Smarters 2 project run by Cretan Initiative to upcycle textiles which would otherwise have been sent to landfill. The draft plan also acknowledges the important role Scotland's forests have to play in tackling climate change. By 2032, forests and woodland will cover an additional 3% of the Scottish land area, meaning Scotland's woodlands will be better placed to provide natural flood defences. Currently, in Galloway, the forest cover is almost 30% across the region. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's ambition for Scottish food producers to be among the lowest carbon and most efficient in the world. And last week, I met with the new NFU Scotland President and Vice Presidents here in Parliament, and collectively, they understand both the necessity of cutting emissions and the advantages to their own businesses of doing so. Since 1990, emissions from the industry have reduced significantly. And as reflected in the committee's report, there is a belief that more needs to be committed to for agriculture and indeed transport, as has been mentioned. However, there are challenges facing the sector which we need to be conscious of. Almost half of the global warming agricultural emissions are from methane produced by biological sources, as Cabinet Secretary Rosanna Cunningham did talk about. These biological sources are our cow and our sheep. Methane released from the livestock, mostly by the oral route, I'd like to add, is not easily controlled. And it is important to acknowledge that and to work collaboratively with all farmers and all involved to help reduce emissions wherever possible. Personally, I was pleased to hear from the Cabinet Secretary that there will be no immediate requirement for farmers to undertake compulsory soil testing. The intent that all improved land is tested routinely for pH remains the same, and compulsory testing will be introduced as a staged process. We already know that the behaviour of conscientious farmers, driven by the need to evidence what corrective soil pH improvement action they plan, is already being implemented widely. And of course, pH testing in itself does not reduce greenhouse gas emissions. It's what's done with the results that matters. So I firmly believe that the practice changes can best be achieved by working collaboratively with farmers. I'm therefore pleased that the Scottish Government plans to engage with farmers and crofters to increase understanding of environmental and economic benefits of low-carbon farming. Many farmers I have spoken to are in fact already taking significant voluntary steps in the right direction. Last week, I visited Scottish Tenant Farmer Association Chairman Chris Nicholson at his farm in the Machers near Whithorn. Chris has been practising conservation tillage, so I was learning about that. For those unfamiliar with the term, it's a method of soil cultivation which deliberately leaves residue from the previous crop, a cover crop, no ploughing. Chris hasn't ploughed his fields for 30 years. This has various environmental advantages, like increasing the ability of the soil to sequester carbon and reducing use of fossil fuels when ploughing. However, expert evidence taken at the committee from Peter Smith from Aberdeen stated that conservation tillage can help to sequester some carbon, but the amount of carbon is often overstated. And if I had to describe it much longer, it would take me longer than my 5 minutes. So when speaking to the NFU leadership in Parliament last week as well, they stressed that one of the most important things we can do to help the sector reduce emissions is to encourage locally produced Scottish food to be purchased by schools, NHS and others. As a member of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee, I look forward to continue working with the committee members and working with the Scottish Government to address climate change.
Well done, Ms Harper. On the button. Finlay Carson, to be followed by Gail Ross, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to take part in today's debate on the draft climate change plan. Climate change is one of the greatest challenges we face, and we must have ambitious plans not only to look to repair the damage, but also improve our environment in the future. All of us have a duty to the next generation to leave Scotland in a better state than we found it in. The Scottish Government's climate change plan provides a framework for the transition to a low-carbon Scotland, and this is something I'm sure we can all get on board with. However, we on these benches cannot get on board with as yet more missed targets and slipping deadlines from this government. It's simply not good enough to paint a strong narrative without the specific policies to ensure that we achieve these climate change targets. And that's not just my view. The WWF said of the draft plan, and I quote, "Although the plan presents an often strong description of a low-carbon economy in 2030, there is a consistent absence of sufficient specific policies in almost every sector to ensure we achieve our climate targets through to 2032. And Stop Climate Chaos Scotland said the plan lacks transparency and credibility. However, we need to do more than just get reassuring words from this plan. Peatland, last week in the biodiversity debate, I touched on the importance of peatland and contributing to a sustainable future for Scotland. The peatland restoration programme currently underway as part of the 15% degraded ecosystem restoration target set by the EU. Professor Robin Matthews of the James Hutton Institute estimates that restoring 21,000 hectares annually, a figure which he calls modest, would contribute to an 8% reduction in the total Scottish carbon emissions. However, since 2013, the Scottish Government have only restored 10,000 hectares. This Government had set itself a target of increasing the annual rate of peatland restoration from 10,000 hectares in 2017-18 to 20,000 hectares per year thereafter. The Scottish Conservatives want to ensure that this ambitious commitment to restore degraded peatland is delivered, which will help also to protect against flooding as well as a natural carbon sink. This would not only benefit the climate, but the economy too. By providing long-term investment to these projects, it has the potential to create much-needed local jobs. But the issue isn't just lack of restoration.
Commercial peat extraction is damaging and destroying some of Scotland's valuable raised bogs. Scotland's deepest peat stores around 6,500 million tonnes of CO2, 10 times as much carbon as stored in the whole of the UK forest biomass. A loss of just 1.6% of this peatland carbon is equivalent to the total annual human carbon emissions in Scotland. Scotland's area of intact raised bog has declined from 28,000 hectares to 2,500 hectares over the last two decades, and commercial peat extraction is a major contributor to this. I would suggest that the Scottish Government may need to take a look at its policy on peat extraction, because it seems contrary that licences are being granted to extract peat at the same time as the Government is investing in restoration of degraded peatland. RPP2 has had a section on blue carbon, indicating the research in the area was underdeveloped, but that the Scottish Government was working to establish further information. However, in this climate change plan, there's absolutely no mention of blue carbon. When this was raised with the Cabinet Secretary in committee, she said that scientific data is still not mature enough to base firm policies and proposals on. Given that lack of information on blue carbon, and that it was highlighted in RPP2, I find it disheartening that the Scottish Government appears to have taken no steps to populate this information abyss. Removing blue carbon completely from the pan looks like an attempt by the Government to pull wool over our eyes on this one. To conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, I would welcome steps to tackle climate change and reduce Scotland's carbon emission as far as they go. However, we need a plan that has the substance to achieve this rather than simply reassuring words.
Thank you, Mr. Carson. Gail Ross, to be followed by Richard Leonard. Ms. Ross, please.
Thank you, President Officer. Climate change is the single biggest threat to life on this planet as we know it. And we all know that the time has passed to stand by and do nothing. In Scotland, we have had world-leading climate change legislation, and as the Cabinet Secretary said earlier, we exceeded our targets 6 years early, thanks to a combined effort of thanks to a combined effort of cutting emissions.
I think that was a no, Mr. Finlay.
And investment in renewable energy. Better timing, Neil Finlay, please. Through this new climate change plan, or CCP, we continue to set targets, strive for change in all sectors, as well as societal and cultural change. But are our ambitions actually ambitious? Presiding Officer, I am the Deputy Convener of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, and you earlier heard our convener, Edward Mountain, very ably set out the committee's position and explained our report in some detail. As a committee, we took evidence from many professionals and experts, including knowledgeable farmers, listened to opinions and experience, and worked together to produce this report. And I must also commend my fellow committee members for their hard work and for the spirit of consensus in which this conclusion was reached, and also thank the clerks and all involved. As a committee, as you've heard, we have responsibility for two of the biggest polluting sectors, transport and agriculture, and feedback from both sectors on the plan, the draft plan, was mixed. Firstly, I would like to touch on transport. It has generally been agreed that we should put more emphasis on active travel, and the aim of making 10% of journeys by bike by 2020 is ambitious, given the fact that we are currently only at 1%. And replacing car use wherever possible will have to be a huge cultural shift. Walking or cycling short distances instead of jumping in the car can no longer be seen as the preferred option. Now, no one is saying that the Highland weather is always conducive to active travel, but we do need to make more of an effort in this regard, and we do need more information from the government on how this will be achieved. Public transport. Transform Scotland tell us in their briefing that there is no specific policy in the CPP. Yes, with pleasure.
Liam Kerr.
Just before you move on to that.
Mr. Kerr now he's managed to get an intervention. Mr. Kerr.
I met with Transform Scotland yesterday, and they were saying that the climate change plan places an over-reliance on ultra-low emissions vehicles and electric vehicles. Are they wrong?
Gail Ross.
I would invite Liam Kerr to actually read the report of the Rural Economy and Connectivity, where we do specifically talk about low-emission vehicles. And as he'll know, there are schemes around the country that can be used as good practice. hydrogen buses in Aberdeen, and we also have electric buses in Edinburgh. So we are we did look at that. Thanks for that very useful intervention there. According to figures from Transport Scotland, there has been a decline of 10% in bus usage in the past 5 years. And therefore, it is hard to see how a considerable shift away from private cars can be achieved. Now, to address this point, in rural areas, people will tell you that they need their cars to get around. So this modal shift also needs to be accompanied by changes to timetabling of bus services in rural communities with frequent, reliable services on offer. Moving on, Presiding Officer, we realise that agriculture as a sector faces huge challenges when it comes to decarbonisation. However, there are many who have taken steps to mitigate climate change with schemes such as peatland restoration, renewable energy and forestry, although it is acknowledged that much more can and should be done to help support farmers and landowners to plant trees. And Edward Mountain touched on this as well. We have to plant more trees. We know this. We have missed our targets year on year for various reasons, but we understand these reasons, and we now have put plans in place to address this and improve planting rates in future. And that is something that, as a committee, we will continue to scrutinise. My constituency is home to the biggest blanket bog in the world, the Flow Country. It has been referred to as the Amazon of the Northern Hemisphere due to the amount of carbon it sequesters. And at this point, I must also pay tribute to my predecessor, Rob Gibson, the Moss Boss, for his tireless promotion of peatland areas. And I also welcome the additional £8 million in the Scottish Government budget to help restore peatlands, protect wildlife and sustain tourism and rural jobs. The Cabinet Secretary has made it clear her commitment to listening to all the feedback, considering each report in detail and bringing it back to Parliament before the final draft. And I look forward to engaging her further on this vital issue. It was said before that the climate change plan was half-baked. Well, if we're going to put it in a cooking context, I would say that the ingredients are there. We just have to work to get the amounts correct in order for the recipe to work. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Richard Leonard, followed by Stuart Stevenson. Mr. Leonard, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As the months and years proceed, it becomes clearer that whilst the conditions for tackling climate change in a democracy demand that we win over and so change public opinion, and so in turn transform individual patterns of behaviour, the driving force to that change will be found first and foremost in the means of production, in the means of distribution, and in the means of exchange in the economy, which in turn will come down to who owns and who controls those means, those systems of production, distribution, and exchange. It becomes clearer too that we have to say farewell to the creed that a high rate of consumption equals a high standard of living, because it is no longer valid in as much as it ever was. We will have to leave behind the very philosophy which underpins the acquisitive society, and we will have to put great science in the service of the people rather than putting people subservient to great science. And in so doing, we have to plan a sustainable alternative to the irresistible march of materialism. Now, the government has brought forward its latest climate change plan based upon a new model, the Times model. And to the Cabinet Secretary and to her ministerial team, I say that calling it, and if I can quote their words, a high-level strategic model is no doubt designed to impress us, but it remains no more than a model nonetheless. So it is based upon a set of assumptions which runs according to specially designed weightings, which is constructed with theoretical abstractions and held together with linkages from one to the other. And it is a model with many vital parts missing, like agriculture, transport, waste, and so on. So we should take heed of the words of the mathematician and philosopher Alfred North Whitehead, who almost a century ago warned people using these kind of models of the fallacy of misplaced concreteness. So the Times model should be a guide, a tool, but it should inform, not dictate, public policy. And so when we read warnings that the model's outputs are rigged, or in the more diplomatic words of WWF, and I quote, the backloaded profile of low carbon heat is a direct result of constraints imposed upon the Times model by the Scottish Government, it is right that this afternoon we seriously question the suggestion by the Scottish Government that we can move from 80% of Scotland's domestic heating supplied from mains gas in 2017 to 80% of our domestic heating supply from low-carbon technology by 2032. It is right that we question it further when the government does not propose to begin any of this work in earnest until 2025. When the Minister for Business Innovation and Energy was before the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee, I put to him that he seemed to be jogging between now and 2025 and sprinting flat out between 2025 and 2032. And as someone pointed out to me, continuing the metaphor, he also seems to be stopping for a lengthy fag break in between his jog and his sprint, because according to this published plan, low carbon heat is stuck at 18% between 2020 and 2025, of course.
Paul Wheelhouse.
Can I point out to Mr. Leonard, A, I don't smoke, B, I don't jog, but also the point is that in answering his question in committee, I also made the point that we also have to develop a supply chain and build the skills base to unroll a massive programme, the single biggest programme of energy efficiency investment in Scotland's history. And that also requires, dare I say it to those who are in favour of Brexit, a supply of skills which may require from the continent as well. Where are the Polish plumbers going to come from and other nationalities who've been instrumental in helping our construction sector in recent years?
Richard Leonard.
Yeah, I thank the Minister for that intervention, but the committee concluded that the Scottish Government should not backload the domestic and non-domestic heat conversion plan, they should front-load it. And I say in all sincerity to the Cabinet Secretary, and I don't think she should look so worried. I don't think she should look so worried about achieving our climate change goals too quickly that people will be taken by surprise by an environmental coup d'etat. I don't think she or the rest of us should live in fear of too much vitality. I think we should fear too little vitality. Just look at the abject failure to meet our fuel poverty targets, which is why we need rising investment in energy efficiency, not standstill investment in energy efficiency. And as I've said to the government many times, working with the trade unions and industry, they should start preparing now the skill sets of our workers for these new jobs. They should start now equipping our manufacturing industries and supply chain to provide these new jobs. It's not enough to show political leadership and bold ambition. We need economic leadership and a credible plan as well. Absolutely. If we had a clear plan
Please
for jobs,
close.
It would provide real hope, built on radical but credible plans, driven by uncompromising leadership. With real hope, we would get the change that we need, and it will be achieved in the interests of working people for the common good.
Can I remind members how short of time we are, and any time over will be taken from colleagues, I'm afraid. Now, Stuart Stevenson, followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Picking up on what Richard Leonard has just quoted from Alfred Lord Whitehead, I would give another quotation, which is, all our choices and actions have consequences for the world around us. And that's something I think we can all agree with, because we are talking about the anthropogenic effects on climate change. I personally am particularly interested in the one-by-one approach. In other words, it's all very well all this technology, it's all very well the government taking actions, but ultimately it will require each individual in our society, one by one, to identify actions that they can take that will help this particular agenda. I'm contributing a little bit to active travel this week. I've walked 17 miles so far. It's not a huge amount. Sounds a lot when you sort of add it up day by day. It's not a huge amount, but it's better than getting the taxi up to the station every day. Walking is a little bit fitter and better for the climate. But there is a significant challenge that comes from individual behaviours. When I first came to the Parliament, I was driving 40,000 miles a year. I now drive about 7,000 or 8,000 miles a year. Very rural constituency, I can't eliminate it all. I now use the train in a way that I certainly didn't use. And thanks to the bus pass, thanks to the bus pass introduced by the previous Liberal administration, I use the bus as well. But we're in a time of unprecedented challenge on the agenda of climate change. And this is where Gordon Lyndhurst was quite wrong when he said the whole world recognises the problem. Only yesterday, the President of the United States, Donald Trump, cut the Environmental Protection Agency budget by 31%, the biggest cut in his proposed budget of any part of public administration in the United States. And he has populated the administration of that agency with a whole raft of people who are climate change deniers. We are days away from the resiling from the signing of the Paris Agreement. So we're in unprecedented challenge territories that we have little control over. So it is important that we do the best and the most that we possibly can. So far, so good, reaching our 2020 target years ahead of the plan is great. The 66% target we are setting for 2032 is ambitious, and the next part of our implementation of climate change plans will be more challenging than the part that we've already undertaken. I'm of the sort of age where I occasionally give on a day when I'm feeling a little bit lower than I might be today. Today was a spring in my step as to what my obituary might say. I may be described as the Minister for Snow, which was given to me because the forecast was 0.4 of a degree Celsius out, and therefore, et cetera, et cetera. But I hope that the obituary might say that I was the Minister who took the Climate Change Bill through. But it was a very important bill for this Parliament because it achieved absolute unanimity when we passed it. And I hope that as we look at this plan, capable of improvement, as it undoubtedly is, that we can achieve the kind of unanimity that will help take us forward. Now, some of the things that are discussed in the plan and have come up in the debate so far are about technological solutions. And yes, let's encourage every possible technological opportunity that's going to help this agenda. A, because it is helping the agenda, but B, because also, if we are taking the initiative, it creates business opportunities for us. And carbon capture and storage is certainly one of them, particularly where we're talking about gas-powered stations. We've got to get it off gas. But while we've got gas, we can use gas more efficiently and with a much lower carbon footprint. But let's just enter a couple of caveats. The whole idea that we're going for low emission vehicles, particularly if they're electrically powered, in the middle term, there are significant challenges. Because we're actually, as a world, beginning to reach sight of our limitations on the amount of lithium there is. The technology for batteries is lithium-ion technology. Hasn't really changed much for 30 years. Lots of good things in the laboratory, particularly nanocarbon fiber cathodes that might help, but there are still issues. They're burning away with the acid. So I hope that technology does help. Let me just close, Presiding Officer, by quoting John Gummer from the Climate Change Committee yesterday. Over 8 years, measures to combat climate warming have cut carbon emissions without raising any electricity bills for UK homelands. There's households, there's lots of myths around. We've got to demolish them, but we've a lot of work to do. I know the government will want to do it.
I have Jamie Green, followed by Angus MacDonald.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It was a very welcome and pleasant surprise to find that the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee was to review the draft climate change plan. I know that Edward Mountain spoke on behalf of the committee, but I would like to add some further thoughts of my own as a member of that committee. We covered the subjects of agriculture, transport and forestry, and it is within those three topics that I would like to share some of the evidence that we took in the hope that it might inform, influence, but also guide the government in its plan. Now, I welcome many of the Scottish Government's measures to reduce carbon emissions across agriculture, transport, and forestry. I think we all agree that everyone has a role to play. But it is important to note in this debate that within these sectors are many jobs, livelihoods, and microeconomies. The farmers are balancing the needs to make ends meet whilst taking into account the needs of a sustainable economy. So I too welcome the approach of the Cabinet Secretary for the Rural Economy, who prefers to encourage behavioural change rather than through enforcement. But the committee did note that the government ought to reserve the right to take further steps if voluntary measures do not succeed. We also took substantial evidence, in my view, which laid bare a lack of clarity around carbon reductions. On the issue of forestry, but not only are we missing planting targets, but thought must be given to the types of forestry being planted, and more importantly, where these trees are being planted. The James Hutton Institute noted that achieving planting targets does not always equate to meeting CO2 reduction targets. Going further, they felt that the climate change plan actually presents no real target on emission reduction achieved via planting. It's no great secret that by 2050, the UK may be importing up to 80% of its timber requirements. So planting targets are about much more than just climate change. Moving on to transport, much was said about forecasts and assumptions made by the government on the take-up of low-emission and electric vehicles. As Professor Rye outlined in his evidence to the committee on February the 8th, he said, in effect, that policy must support ambition. We took evidence on the example in Norway, where the government converted its ambition on low-emission vehicles take-up through a series of consumer policies. Low-emission vehicle purchases are pretty commonplace in Norway. But this didn't happen simply by asking or willing people to change. The government introduced a series of measures to attract ownership of such vehicles, such as zero purchase tax, reduced road tax, free public parking, no VAT, no toll fees, free access to bus lanes, and so on. Now, these might not be universally popular, or indeed they may not all be right for Scotland. In fact, some of those may have financial implications on the public purse. But nonetheless, wishing something to happen doesn't make it happen. We can't rely on the environmental kindness of consumers to change their car. There must be a win-win if widespread change is a realistic goal. Equally, we can't rely on the love of the environment to get people out of their cars onto public transport. In many rural areas, such as in the west of Scotland, where I live, the car is simply a necessity. But I do think that innovating for sustainability and consumer innovation are not mutually exclusive. New technologies, like smart metering, for example, is reshaping consumer behaviour in home energy, in agriculture, GPS technology, and improvements in timber felling technology are vastly improving previously quite onerous processes. Technology is similarly suited to improve public transport. Phil Matthews of Transport Scotland said to the committee that improved information sharing with the public, such as apps which show bus time arrivals, will contribute to getting people onto public transport. But even he admitted that targets in the plan were predicated on a range of unknowns. I quote from him, "There are technological unknowns, and a lot of the possible actions are predicated on action that is outwith the control of the Scottish Parliament," close quote. So in summary, I'd like to think that the Scottish Government will reflect and duly act on all the suggestions of the various committees who have spoken today, but not just them, listen to the experts and the stakeholders who are often those most directly affected by the policy implications of this plan. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't want to be cutting speaking times off those closing for the committees, so can I ask the remaining speakers to aim for 4.5 minutes, please? Angus MacDonald, followed by Neil Findlay.
Okay, thank you, President Officer. Given the wide remit the ECRA committee report covers, it's impossible to speak on all the issues in such a short speech, especially 4.5 minutes, so I'll endeavour to cover what I can. As we've already heard from the convener of the ECRA committee and other committee members, there's a general chorus of welcome for the ambitious targets for peatland restoration and, of course, the wider benefits for water and air quality, biodiversity, flood prevention and the jobs that'll bring. Yesterday's announcement that the Peatlands Action Fund is open for funding applications and will deliver an £8 million investment to restore peatlands and help reduce carbon emissions is heartening and will help ensure the Scottish Government delivers on its proposals to restore 250,000 hectares of peatlands by 2032. Now, around 1.7 million hectares of Scotland is covered in peatlands, and keeping them well maintained mitigates against climate change by locking in carbon. So the peatland restoration work funded by the Government since 2013 has already transformed, as we've heard already, more than 10,000 hectares. And I was pleased to see at first hand the restoration of peat bog on the Somannan Plateau to the southwest of Falkirk late last year. And as we saw at an excellent event hosted by my colleague Graeme Dey on Tuesday night and presented by Andrew McBride of SNH, if the peatlands are left in a degraded condition, they produce greenhouse gas emissions rather than act as a sink for soaking up carbon. So with this extra funding, we're heading in the right direction, although there's no doubt there's more to do. Now, our committee has suggested in its report that the Scottish Government should explore how it can use its powers to prevent peat-based products being sold in Scotland. And during our evidence-taking session with the Cabinet Secretary, I suggested that there should be a levy or tax on the use of peat for horticultural use, in line with a campaign started in 2011 by the RSPB, SWT, Bug Life and Plant Life, to name just a handful of the NGOs involved. Now, the Cabinet Secretary will recall that she responded that she didn't think we have the power in Scotland to introduce such a tax or levy. However, I would counter, perhaps naively, as I don't know for sure, but if we have the legislation to introduce a carrier bag charge, then we surely have the power to introduce some form of disincentive to using peat for horticultural use. Indeed, there was consensus among witnesses at our evidence-taking sessions that horticultural use of peat should be prohibited. Professor of Soils and Global Change, Pete Smith of the University of Aberdeen, agreed by saying, and I quote, "I think that that sort of activity is inconsistent with our climate targets. Just as the UK has moved to phase out coal, we ought, in my opinion, to have a plan to phase out the horticultural use of peats," end quote. Now, as was discussed at the SNH event on Tuesday night during the Q&A session, there are plenty of alternatives to peat compost and many peat-free composts, such as commercial green compost, wood brash and forestry waste, work as effectively as peat ones. So in short, we cannot on the one hand claim to be a world-leading country when it comes to climate change, but stand idly by and watch some of our high-carbon specialist habitats, our rainforest equivalent, if you like, being ripped up and squandered. Of course, an added incentive would be for the proceeds from any levy to be used towards the estimated £16 million a year required to meet the annual peatland restoration target of 20,000 hectares per year. Now, I realise time is tight, Presiding Officer, given there are so many speakers in this debate, so in closing, I'd like to touch on the very welcome All Singing, All Dancing Times model, which was used, as we know, to model future greenhouse gas emissions from each sector of the economy. However, it wasn't as all singing and all dancing as our committee and some NGOs out there would have liked, although it's fair to say, despite comments in the chamber this afternoon, everyone is impressed with the Times model and recognises the significant improvement on the approach used for RPP1 and RPP2. So without any doubt, the Scottish Government is right to use Times for RPP3 and to develop it for RPP4. However, the committee noted that there were issues with the lack of transparency in the Times model, which will make it difficult to determine whether emissions reductions in the finalised plan have been sufficient. Presiding Officer, if our ECLR committee and indeed the Scottish Parliament as a whole is to come to a view on how robust and achievable the final climate change plan is, we must have considerably more data around some of the specific measures. So I look forward to the final RPP3 climate change plan being laid in Parliament once these issues hopefully have been taken on board, which along with the energy strategy will deliver a low carbon transition for Scotland which promotes social inclusion and sustainable growth. Thank you.
May I have Neil Findlay followed by John Mason.
Presiding Officer, I want to focus my comments on two areas where we need real action, and that's on energy and transport. Fundamental to the whole issue of energy provision is the ownership and control of energy supply. In recent years, Scotland has been at the forefront of renewables development, but is it in this area that I believe we've seen one of the greatest missed opportunities of our times? The development of wind energy has been dominated by multinationals, venture capital firms, and indeed Tory MSPs that see Scotland's wind as their latest commodity and will do whatever it takes, including trampling over the concerns of communities, to take advantage of the significant profits that are open to them. Community benefit schemes, of course, exist. Limited share ownership exists. But the sums involved are a drop in the ocean compared to the money that's been made by the big European companies that dominate the scene. We could have had these projects owned and operated collectively by the community. Public investment by councils, the Forestry Commission, NHS, pension funds, credit union reserves, communities and others, returning profits to the public services and for investment in jobs and the common good. Instead, we see, with every turn of a turbine, scarce cash fluttering off to the boardrooms of Paris, Frankfurt and Madrid. It could all have been so different. But we still have time to prevent any new renewables developments going the same way. I won't hold my breath on that, but I do live in hope. Now, turning to transport and the emissions related to air travel. The Scottish Government simply cannot demonstrate how they will tackle the increased emissions that will come from their proposal to slash, then ditch, air passenger duty.
putting to the side tax breaks for business flyers and a loss of tax revenues to the public purse. On environmental grounds alone, it is absurd to remove air passenger duty. The 2014 Transport Scotland study on the impact a reduction in APD would make notes business air travel is inelastic to a change in prices. In other words, journeys by air can generally not be replaced by another form of transport. Leisure air travel is income elastic, in other words, a luxury, so price is more sensitive. So if price reduces, demand is likely to increase. So this policy change will reduce government revenue, benefit the people who can already afford to travel by air, and they may travel more often by air, and will be detrimental to the environment. On which planet is this a sensible policy choice? The negative impact has been acknowledged by committee members, Transport Scotland and environmental groups. When the committee questions the Cabinet Secretary for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform on the negative environmental impact of air travel expansion due to the slashing of APD, she repeatedly failed to provide the detail. The Cabinet Secretary cannot explain how or which other sectors will need to see additional reductions to compensate for increase in emissions from air travel. Presiding Officer, currently Edinburgh Airport, in line with Scottish Government policy, is seeking airport expansion, despite the fact that the airport is nowhere near capacity. In West Lothian, we see huge opposition to these plans, and we have the hypocrisy, the dripping hypocrisy, of two cabinet ministers representing that area, sitting around the cabinet table, agreeing a policy of airport expansion, agreeing a policy of air passenger duty cut, then eradication, then going out into the community pretending they are the champions of that community opposing airport expansion. Hypocrisy is what it is. The Scottish Government own advisers on climate change advise a 22% greater overall reduction in transport emissions in comparison to the draft plan. The Minister, I have watched her during this debate, can throw tantrums, she can wave her hands, she can scowl and try to release a shoal of red herrings to cover the reality. The air passenger duty bill is the environmental equivalent of pouring gallons of petrol on a burning inferno. It makes no sense, no sense whatsoever. And the quicker you scrap that plan, the better it will be for everyone.
I have John Mason, followed by John Scott.
I mean, I think, Presiding Officer, an opening remark. I think one of the issues that Mr. Finlay mistakes is forgetting about the public, forgetting that we live in a democracy, and to move this agenda forward, we need to take the public with us. Now, I have had the privilege of being a member of two of the four committees looking at the draft climate change. Certainly not. Namely, the Economy Committee and Rural Connectivity Committee.
Point of order, Mr. Finlay.
I make no criticism of you in this. I make a criticism of the way in which this debate has been timetabled. The credibility of this Parliament is at stake when we have debates that are curtailed like this and are not debates. All there
Mr.
is a series Finlay, of speeches.
Mr. Finlay, that is not a point of order. I suggest you take it up with your business manager.
All
Mr.
the business
Mason.
Managers.
Yes, I mean, I think Mr. Finlay would gain more respect if he had a little bit more respect for this Parliament as a whole. Now, as I said, I'm on two of the committees, and I think it's good that the committees have taken slightly different angles on this report. I think that's healthy. I think I'm a great believer in the committee system and that it does do well as long as members are not too tribal. Now, as an initial general point, I would just like to say that clearly the EU has had a significant role in driving this whole climate change and environment agenda. And there has to be concern that if this healthy pressure from the EU is removed, if we will really continue without that. Now, there were certain points that were of interest, I think, to both committees, and three of them that I would mention. One, the very tight 60-day timescale, which I think put pressure certainly on the clerks and Spice, certainly on the committees, but also I think on the government to respond to points that were raised by the committees. The REC committee asked for 120 days, the Economy Committee just asked for more time. Hydrogen was an interesting one that came up at both committees in relation both to heating homes and running transport. And my own gut feeling is that hydrogen is certainly worth exploring quite a lot more, because it does seem to offer a flexibility which electricity struggles to do, as Stuart Stevenson was describing with the batteries. And the third point was a desire for more detail, which has been referred to already. Specifically in the Economy Committee, the district heating systems seem very attractive, and we had a very useful visit to Dundee with the committee, and it appeared to be working very well in the multi-storey flats at Lochee. It was a fairly straightforward system because the council seemed to own all of the properties, and I think it was SSE that was their partner. By contrast, I have the Commonwealth Games Village in my constituency, which also has district heating, and it seems to be very highly complex. The residents are not convinced about it, and there are multiple organisations operating and maintaining it, with three housing associations and the occupiers all being charged by different methods. Now, given that the UK and Scotland has a fairly well-developed mains gas network and fairly efficient domestic boilers, witnesses did suggest that alternative gas, probably hydrogen, it might be a good way forward using the existing infrastructure. But I think it is true to say that we do need to decide on this before 2025, as people do take quite a long timescale to replace and keep their boilers. Energy efficiency of homes is a big challenge, especially existing homes, as the plan itself says that 80% of housing will still be in use in 2050. A constituency like mine has many older tenements, so there is a need to plan both for the private rented and the owner-occupier sectors. And although they are fairly standard in one sense, commercial and public buildings are much more varied, and it is going to be very challenging to make them more energy efficient. Moving on to the REC committee, we looked at transport, as has already been mentioned, and there was quite a lot of discussion around should it be purely electric vehicles we aim for, or other low-emission fuels as well. As Jamie Green has said, there's been a big growth in the electric side in Norway as a result of a lot of subsidies. But it was encouraging to hear that Aberdeen is experimenting with hydrogen for buses, as the bus companies tell us that they cannot at the moment have batteries that will last all day for a particular bus. And that's what puts me personally off having an electric car when I cannot go a long distance without having to recharge it. I think there was a bit of uncertainty around the growth of transport, whether it's 20%, 7% assumption or a target, and that can maybe be clarified, but I think I have run out of time. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Can I have John Scott to be followed by Kate Forbes?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as in any debate regarding land use and climate change, may I begin by declaring an interest as a farmer and owner of peatland. Although today I want to talk specifically about transport and the rather dismaying committee's views that the Scottish Government's lack of consistent methodology, modelling and transparency in the draft climate change plan. It would be bad enough if it was only the four committees' views that this draft plan lacked vision, ambition and policy focus with regard to transport, agriculture and the built environment. But the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the briefs we have received from the NGOs as well all appear to share that view too. That all of the four committees, after criticising the draft plan, have declared their intention to revisit the substantial issues raised and add this to their already substantial workloads is almost unheard of, and the Government should be taking very careful note. And turning now to the Scottish Government's specific lack of ambition for transport, and the glaring one appears to me at any rate to be car usage. The UK Committee on Climate Change believes a 12% reduction in kilometres travelled by car is possible by 2030. Yet our Scottish Government expects a 27% growth in distances travelled over the same period. Worse still, the Climate Change Committee envisages 60% of new sales of cars and vans by 2030 will be electric vehicles. Yet our Government's plan foresees less than half that percentage figure of sales and electric vehicles at only 27%. So why is the Scottish Government shying away from seeking to achieve the same targets for electric vehicles as the countries of Norway, Sweden and the Netherlands, who usually they are seeking to emulate in terms of best practice? Is it because they are not prepared to make the investment to bring about such change, for example, by installing sufficient charging points or creating incentives to encourage the increased usage of ultra-low emission vehicles? Recently, in discussion with a transport expert, it was suggested to me that one of the ways to increase usage of low-emission vehicles is to have charged battery swapping points, strategically placed around Scotland, where instead of stopping for an hour or two or three to charge up your own car's battery, you swap your car's battery for an identical battery that is fully charged, thereby increasing the range, reliability and flexibility of low-emission electric vehicles. Of course, this would require the development of standardised batteries, which could be easily and reliably swapped over at recharging stations. But such a move could overcome the fear of many of being left stranded in an electric vehicle with a flat battery. And on the subject of increasing the energy efficiency of future vehicles, lessons should be learned from the aircraft manufacturing industry, where composites are already the new material of choice in the aircraft of the future. This new lightweight, laminated carbon-based material, while still expensive just now, will be a new material more readily available to car manufacturers in future, which, as in the aircraft manufacturing industry, will reduce the weight of new cars using this material and also increase the range and efficiencies of such vehicles. Of course, modal shift has to be encouraged too, to decongest our already overburdened motorway networks, and that is about making our trains and buses yet more attractive to lifelong car users like me. Tipping points in modal shift will come if pursued by government, but they must be achieved by incentivising the travelling consumer to the point where logically modal shift becomes the only sensible option for many. For me and others of my age group, modal shift is about walking or cycling, where before taking the car would have been the preferred option. Combined with the health messages about obesity, the risk of type 2 diabetes, exercise as the new wonder drug for the baby boomers will also drive change into physical modal shift as well as prolong active life. So, Presiding Officer, this is a time to be bold about Scotland's further carbon reduction potential, and the Cabinet Secretary's leadership is vital in explaining and encouraging and delivering such a vision for Scotland. More needs to be done, and we look forward to our update before the summer recess. Thank you.
You have Kate Forbes, to be followed by Mike Rumbles.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to congratulate the Government on publishing its draft climate plan and commend the work of our committee and the other committees in shaping the report that was published last week. It was great to start the process of reviewing and reading the draft climate plan, having taken evidence from the Chair of the Climate Change Committee, who stated that there is no doubt that Scotland is certainly doing better than any other part of the United Kingdom. But today I want to draft my argument in terms of human choices and human behaviour. It's good to have four different committees in the chamber today, and we've all looked in different ways at the different policies. But I think it's so critical that in terms of moving this debate on, we need to look at the cultural and the societal shifts and how we influence people's behaviours. Because policies will only go so far. They can certainly influence behaviour, but there are other aspects that change habits. If I look back at my own lifetime and look at the habits that have changed across society over the last 26 years, there have been quite a number of changes where people have chosen to change their own individual habits. There's been changed habits amongst communities and across society as a whole. Now, in the draft climate change plan, there is the ISM approach, and ISM stands for individual, social and material, which are the three different contexts that influence people's behaviour. So the individual level includes an individual's values, attitudes and skills. The social context includes factors that influence us through networks, relationships and social norms. And the material context covers factors like infrastructure, technologies, and regulations. And all three complement each other and are necessary to change the culture in recognizing climate change, and taking positive action individually and as groups to reduce its impact. So if I go through these three briefly, taking individual first, this is where education and factual information is so important, starting from the very youngest, starting from nurseries, and also helping people to see that they have a personal stake in climate change. In other words, if we don't act, This will affect us, it's already affecting us, and it will affect the next generation. Now, this can also be done indirectly. If I look at the Highlands and the creation of thousands of jobs in the renewable industry across Scotland, that too helps to ensure that there's greater awareness than ever of climate change. Individuals are taking positive action against climate change. Again, I look at a number of businesses in my own constituency. I've mentioned Glenue again in this chamber before, where those businesses have chosen to rely entirely on renewable energy. But then turning to social, which is the second impact, and that's where the importance of charities, of non-profit organisations, of even religious organisations in taking positive steps to influence and incorporate climate change into their overall message and mission. I've even heard of such a thing as eco-congregations, the eco-congregation scheme, which is a programme to enthuse and equip churches. And then lastly, material. And that, I suppose, is primarily where the role of government sits, but not just the Scottish Government. It needs to be a cooperative and a collaborative approach with local authorities and other public bodies. There's been some excellent work in the past with local authorities drafting the Scottish Climate Change Declaration, and since then emissions directly attributable to local authorities have been dropping. And we need to work with governments across Europe and across the world to establish best practice and to share ideas. One of the things that I most appreciated in the draft plan is the emphasis on communities. So the Scottish Government has funded the £75.7 million of Climate Challenge Fund, which has awarded funds to 588 communities in order to reduce local carbon emissions. And again, that's giving people the opportunity to identify where they can play their part and have a stake in the future. So in conclusion, I would just like to emphasise that it's important that we focus on changing people's behaviour if we want to have a long-term impact. Thank you.
I call Mike Rumbles to be followed by Andy Whiteman.
The Scottish Government's draft climate change plan is simply not good enough. That is not just the view of the Liberal Democrats, but is highlighted again and again in these committee reports we are debating today. The draft plan lacks ambition, and the Scottish Government is simply not clear enough, even when it does outline what it wants to achieve. Now, I want to concentrate my remarks specifically on the report of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, of which I'm a member, and within that, I want to focus on transport issues. For me, the biggest elephant in the room is the colossal amount of carbon emissions that will occur as a result of the Scottish Government's aim of cutting air passenger duty to encourage more flights. Witnesses to the committee were concerned that cutting air passenger duty would have a detrimental effect on carbon emissions and reduce the demand for rail travel. I was particularly concerned when the Transport Minister himself said in response that increased emissions were a possibility. The committee was polite in its conclusions on this point, and Edward Mountain always is a polite and effective convener in getting everybody to agree, the committee 100%, and I quote from the conclusions: the committee recommends that the potentially negative impact on carbon levels as a result of the proposed reduction in air passenger duty should be clearly covered in the climate change plan. It is not covered, of course, because it would be embarrassing for the government if it were. Well, it would be embarrassing for the government. That's why it's not there. And why is this? Because air travel is the highest emitter of carbon dioxide per passenger kilometre, of course.
John Mason.
I don't understand why he thinks it would be embarrassing. I mean, clearly, we've got pluses and minuses in this whole scheme, and if you have a plus in one area, you just have something to counteract it.
Mike Rumbles.
If that was the case, why is the government not clearly wanting to put this in the draft plan when it knows it's going to be really important? It is the only sector where emissions have risen significantly in Scotland over the last 20 years. Well, pumping an estimated 60,000 tonnes of carbon into Scotland's air each year will not exactly help the situation, will it? I obviously, earlier on, hit a nerve with the minister when I intervened on her, because rather than address my question, she accused me of being deaf, and it was obviously meant as an insult, but I thought ministers were here to answer our questions rather than hurl insults about the chamber. Now, I want to turn to another aspect of transport policy highlighted in our committee's report. The government's agency, Transport Scotland, start with an assumption that there will be 27% more car use in 2035 than there is today. Rather than tackling the causes of demand growth in car travel, the draft climate change plan seems to accept this growth in car use as a given. How complacent. Totally complacent. Turning to bus travel. It's an issue I particularly want raised in the committee, because I think it's really important. The committee noted, and I quote again, that the draft climate change plan does not mention supporting bus companies to a level necessary to reverse the decline in bus patronage. It doesn't do it. At the very time the Scottish Government needs to be expanding the use of free bus travel, we understand that it's considering raising the eligibility age for this. Now, I know that the government is not clear about its plans, and it won't be clear about its plans, so I assume until after May the 4th, but really, they should be expanding this programme and not thinking of curtailing it or reducing it or raising the age eligibility. I was surprised that the Transport Minister said in evidence to the committee that he thought the free bus pass policy wasn't working because people had not given up their cars. However, I pointed out to him in committee that that wasn't the point of the policy. The free bus pass introduced by the Labour and Liberal Democrat coalition has been a tremendous success, as it was designed to encourage people to use public transport more. It was never designed to replace the car, but to reduce car use, and I thought the Transport Minister might have understood that. This policy is a win-win for everyone. It reduces the environmental impact of car journeys, it reduces congestion in our cities and towns, and it is enormously helpful in getting more people out and about. It is a success story. So that success story, far from proposing to raise the age, we should be encouraging its use, and I would urge the government really to think again. Deputy Presiding Officer, there is a huge amount to cover in the draft climate change plan, but as you've just pointed out, time is too short. Suffice to say that we consider this plan to be far too timid, lacking in vision, completely lacking in ambition. Really, if I were marking the progress card of the Scottish Government, I would say it could do so much better.
The last of the open speeches, please, is Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is one of the most important debates, I think, Parliament can engage in. I want to thank all the committees that have produced reports, and particularly the two committees that I serve on, the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work and Energy Committee, which is the name I'd like to change it to, and the Local Government and Communities Committee. The significance of this topic, of course, has been made clear in this debate, and I think is clear to everyone. The Paris targets of 2015 commit us to a 2-degree reduction in global temperatures and to pursue a 1.5-degree target. And countries, however, having ratified this, now are faced with the prospect of having to deliver. So are they taking all the steps necessary to achieve this? Well, the short answer is no, and neither indeed is Scotland, although we do have a class-leading Climate Change Act and have and are reducing emissions. The actions required to hold to 2 degrees are actually outside the bounds of conventional politics in most countries. We say that 2 degrees is acceptable, but we don't act like it is. As Oil Change International in their report last year made clear, to meet a 2 or 1.5 degree global emission at a warming target, global emissions need to peak now, and they need to begin declining immediately. Therefore, and as Greens have made clear, we need to leave, for example, 2/3 of hydrocarbons in the ground. This means no more drilling west of Shetland, no more exploration around Rockall, no more development of existing reserves. Indeed, it means ceasing all fossil fuel development, and above all, it means no fracking. Scottish ambitions, nevertheless, are welcome to the extent that we can take action, and the range of committee reports and the range of measures in the draft climate change plan are all extremely welcome. But as all reports say, we need to be clearer about how we get to the targets for 2032. In particular, we need greater transparency. We've been told and heard this afternoon about the constraints placed on the model. I'm particularly interested in the constraints that were placed on agriculture and land use, and have submitted a Freedom of Information request, and I look forward to hearing further about how that constraint, particular constraint, was established. I just want to highlight a few points in regard to energy. The Economy Committee looked at the question of carbon capture and storage and made a few points about whether this was in fact practicable, but nevertheless it certainly should be explored. They noted that its role is unproven, but it could have a potential role in future. This morning, the Department for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy published new energy projections, and they're not assuming much carbon capture and storage in the timeframe of this plan. And it would be helpful, I think, if the government can run this model again with carbon capture and storage stripped out. On electricity, for example, the Scottish Government wants additional thermal capacity. National Grid said this wasn't necessary, and therefore, for the purpose of mitigating climate change, it's not clear whether that indeed is necessary. On heat demand, we looked at the targets of 6% reduction in heat demand in 2032, lacking in ambition, I think, because that's a reduction on projected demands by 2032. Skeptical about that, and certainly noting significant changes are required, particularly in terms of low carbon heat. In terms of homes and housing, we looked at this question in local government committee, and we are seeking explanation from the government about the slow progress. As WWF noted in their evidence to the committee, they say, quote, regulation of the private rented and owner-occupied sectors has been long promised but remains undelivered, despite the relevant ministerial powers having been created in 2009. It featured as a potential enabling measure as far back as RPP1, was included as a concrete proposal in RPP2 and developed with stakeholders to detailed pre-consultation phase through the REAPS working group in the last Parliament. Indeed, it is urgent that we bring forward such a scheme. It should be fairly straightforward to uprate home reports to ensure that fuel energy efficiency targets and carbon budgets are contained with that, to include statutory minimum requirements to bring buildings up to a specified standard, and to insist that's done at a point of sale. This pricing would be built into the price that buyers pay, and it underpins the importance of getting private capital into this programme as well as public capital. On planning, we had a brief look at how planning can contribute. There's only one page out of 170 in the climate change report on planning. It does say it's another essential element of the Scottish Government's approach to meeting climate change targets, and we would certainly agree, and we would certainly advocate that we, in the forthcoming planning bill, we build in the goal of mitigating climate change as a core purpose of the planning framework. Presiding Officer, I'm very pleased that Parliament has undertaken the best scrutiny possible in the time available, but I would echo calls on all committee reports that a bit more time is necessary next time. Greens will continue to engage constructively with the Scottish Government on mitigating climate change. Thank you.
We now move to the closing speeches, and I call on David Stewart. No more than 6 minutes, please, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This has been an excellent debate with thoughtful and insightful contributions from across the chamber. Could I particularly thank members of the Clare Committee, of which I'm a member, and the clerks for all the hard work and dedication preparing the report on the draft climate change plan, but also recognise the work carried out by all the other committees who've been scrutinising the CCP. Presiding Officer, climate change is here today. The impacts do not exist in some sci-fi future. They are here, they are now. They are observable, they are scientifically verifiable and inevitable unless we take action now. And Presiding Officer, whether we're choking in the smog of Los Angeles or watching acid rainfall in the frozen forests of Siberia, climate change recognises no borders as it looks to no flags and it upholds no laws. As Al Gore made clear in An Inconvenient Truth, meeting the challenge of climate change is technologically feasible and economically rational. A sustainable Scotland needs to banish poor air quality, a relic of the Victorian era, and we all know that toxic diesel fumes harm our children, our elderly and the ill, and disproportionately hits those living in disadvantaged urban areas. But we already know what works. Boosting energy efficiency and tackling fuel poverty, investing in public transport and active travel, and changing behaviours. That is the big picture. What about the plan itself? Well, there are a number of assumptions in the modelling of the climate change plan. One is that emissions trading scheme will continue. And the second is that carbon capture and storage will continue to play a key role in the future. The EU emissions trading scheme, as members will know, is the first and indeed the largest gas emissions trading scheme in the world. Membership, and the clue is in the name, is the 28 EU members and the three EEA EFTA members of Norway, Liechtenstein and Iceland. ETS membership will clearly be a negotiating point in the Brexit discussions, but there's no guarantee that a post-Brexit agreement will have Scotland in continued membership. Has the Cabinet Secretary, and maybe in the wind-up the Minister can reply, had any discussions with the UK government about the EU ETS? Would a UK scheme be feasible? But we also know, and evidence to our committee, that a larger scheme is better, and currently the ETS covers about 40% of UK emissions from the heavy polluters. And what about carbon capture and storage? Is it still feasible to have such heavy reliance on CCS in the climate change plan when the UK government are pulling the £1 billion funding? And again, I'd welcome the Minister's comments in closing. This has been a really interesting debate, as I said. It was opened by the convener of my own committee, who said that the CCP is the blueprint for a low-carbon Scotland. He also made the point that some of the work was carried out with the town's model, such as transport and agriculture, which other members also commented on. He also made the point that our committee unanimously felt that compulsory soil testing on improved land was something we could pursue. And I note there's a slight different opinion with some other committees. I think Gordon Lindhart, I'm very sorry, I would love to take you in, but I'm very short of time, I'm sorry about that. On behaviour change, Gordon Lindhurst made the excellent point about how that's vital to any of our planning in the future. We need to look at major, significant and long-lasting change. Bob Doris again made a very useful point about the very important role of local government. Seeing local government as our climate change leaders, our champions to develop our targets. And he also made a very vital point that we need to look very carefully at our energy efficiency plans. Edward Mountain, I thought, made a very fair and very good speech when again he talked about the Tynes model, and he raised some criticisms about the lack of baseline data, the issue of financial information, about monitoring, and how it's really important that we had smart targets. He also raised some concerns, which other members raised, about the extent of active travel, a vital component. The Cabinet Secretary made a very useful point about the fact that, of course, there will be a new bill in light of the Paris Agreement, and that the restoration of peatlands was a vital aspect of the point she raised. Again, that was something that was welcomed by my own committee. She felt that the Tynes model was a step forward, and clearly it's one of, the first government in Europe that's used this for live planning of climate change discussions. She also raised the issue of low emission zones, and understand the government's planning to pilot them in 2018. In conclusion, President Nostrom, I'm very conscious of time. I was reading just the other day that the great military strategist Helmut von Moltke said that no battle plan survives contact with the enemy. Well, the enemy in this context is, of course, climate change. Presiding Officer, the climate change plan, I believe, sets out a positive vision for the future, but we do need to be more ambitious, we need to have clearer actions, and we need to start now. And to finish with the words of Barack Obama, he said that there's no such thing as being too late. And when it comes to climate change, the hour is almost upon us. But if we act here, if we act now, if we place our own short-term interests behind the air that our young people will breathe, the food that they will eat, and the water they will drink, and the hopes and dreams that sustain their lives, then we won't be too late for them. Thank you.
I call Peter Chapman. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interest, especially in agriculture and in renewable energy. I'm glad to see that there has been a broad consensus within this debate that while the SNP's targets are laudable, they are also unlikely to be delivered. Yeah, unfortunately for the Cabinet Secretary, the broad consensus was amongst many speakers that they agreed about the limitations within the plan. Many speakers spoke about the lack of detail in the plans, the lack of information within the plan, making scrutiny difficult, and also the lack of baseline data from where to move forward. And many speakers mentioned these issues. Speakers also spoke about the challenging timescale for scrutiny of these plans, and the REC committee, as we heard from Edward Mountain, has called for 120 days to do this work. and the other committees have also said they would like more time. Transport targets, we've heard, are unlikely to be achieved. And we heard that walking and cycling targets need to be much more ambitious. And we need to be much more ambitious also in driving down the proposed 27% increase in car usage over the next number of years. Many speakers also spoke about the limitations of the Times model itself, although the Cabinet Secretary did defend it. And there's also criticism of the omission of any work about blue carbon, and Finlay Carson certainly highlighted that. But to be fair, the Cabinet Secretary did highlight that much has already been achieved and that we are ahead of our previous targets, and that's to be commended. She also argued that technology must be used to drive emissions down further, and of course that must be part of it. But my own colleague Alec Burnett and others questions how much we can rely on technology, much of which has never even been invented yet. Now, Richard Leonard, he was very critical of the aspiration to go from North Sea gas heating to hydrogen heating to heat our homes by 2032, saying it was unachievable in the timescale. I tend to agree. So anyway, targets are laudable, but as I've said, they are unlikely to be delivered. But that's not to say that it's impossible to deliver them, only that we have seen little evidence that this government is capable of delivering them. Now, I am fully committed to the need for us to improve on how we protect the environment and deal with climate change. And indeed, within agriculture, which is obviously my main interest, great strides have already been made. And I remind everyone that emissions from agriculture are down 25% since 1990. And I reckon that's a good result, given that everyone agrees that it's more difficult to lower emissions in the agricultural sector, and the Cabinet Secretary realised this. Now, much of that change has been down to the successful use of improved technology that has not just been good for the environment, but has also boosted farm profitability. There has been much discussion over the need for soil sampling, and it's a conversation we in agriculture need to have. Not just because there is a mistake and a determination to make it compulsory, which I do not support, but because in the right circumstances, when done properly and comprehensively, it pays huge dividends for farmers. Of course, sampling is just the start. The results must be acted upon, and the lime, phosphate, potash and organic matter levels need to be adjusted as necessary for there to be any benefits achieved. On grade one land, of course, farmers should be sampling, but that doesn't apply on poor hill ground, which never sees lime or fertiliser at any time. In addition, by maximising the application of manures and slurries, by using modern accurate machinery, and then taking full account of the nutrients applied, this can have a dramatic effect on reducing the need for bagged fertiliser. Now, these are practical differences that we can make on the ground without the need for draconian penalties, because the extra work and attention delivers tangible results for our farmers. Education is the key to deliver a win for the environment and for the farmers' bottom line. There are also improvements we can make in animal production, particularly the beef and dairy sectors. And for the record, I am totally opposed to that daft suggestion that telling folk to eat less Scottish beef or drink less Scottish milk will save the planet. But by ensuring high health status, good animal welfare, and pushing for faster growing stock being taken to market as quickly as possible, we can reduce emissions in these key areas. Now, I discussed at length last week the work already undertaken by Scottish farmers to boost biodiversity on their land, and I am happy to say that a similar situation exists when it comes to safeguarding our environment. Farmers are contributing to our climate change targets in pioneering the new technology I've spoken about, but also in restoring peat bogs and planting up acres of trees. And I should reaffirm that we welcome the government's commitment to increasing tree planting targets, although I would add my earlier concerns regarding the likely delivery of that target. The way to continue and improve upon this good work is through showing the benefits to our farmers and encouraging the sceptical of the benefits. We must raise awareness of the business benefits through education, whether through the SRUC or the Monitor Farm programmes, so that we can contribute so much to increasing farm business efficiency and profitability. We have heard today much today on the wing and a prayer method that was used in putting together the SNP's climate change plan. And it is a shame that in this policy area, where there is much common cause across the chamber, that the SNP have felt the need to rush the plan through without proper scrutiny.
You were just that minute too late there, Mr. Dey. I call Paul Wheelhouse. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm sure you agree it has been a lively and interesting debate, although not always a well-informed debate. The Climate Change Act 2009 sets the timescales for consultation on the climate change plan, and that's something I think we all need to recognise. 60 days is what we have to live with in the 2009 Act, and I think members across the chamber would do well to note that. Through the delivery of the climate change plan, we'll work with this Parliament and the people of and businesses of Scotland to continue to drive down emissions by the equivalent of 66% by 2032, an ambition which would not only see us achieve our climate change goals, but reap the many social and economic rewards. We have, of course, reached 5.8% by 2014, 6 years early, as Stuart Stevenson highlighted. And this draft climate change plan delivers a clear roadmap of what policy outcomes need to be delivered and at what scale to hit our emission reduction targets, which has at its root the robust analysis produced by Times and will be supported by our new monitoring framework. Having had first-hand experience leading the team that produced the analytical work, can I just finish a point and I'll bring in Mark Ruskell, leading the analytical work underpinning RPP2, I know that the work that goes into creating a plan that addresses emissions in all areas of society is extremely diligently performed by officers and officials in Scottish Government and extensive consultation. But as the Cabinet Secretary said earlier, we have built upon the experience of the previous RPPs, and Angus MacDonald is quite right that the Times model represents a significant step forward in the Government's carbon planning. And I'll quote, you don't need to trust our word for that, Matthew Bell, the Chief Executive of UK Climate Change Committee, said, and I quote, the Times model is very good, transparent and rigorous framework. And Times has for the first time allowed us to make consistent judgments about where best to focus our efforts and to identify cost-effective pathways. However, we will, of course, consider the committee's views and our approach as we use the model for the final plan. And I'll bring in Mark Ruskell.
Mark Ruskell.
Could I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way? In terms of continuing to use the Times model, could you do another run that basically has carbon capture and storage removed, but increased ambition, particularly around modal shift, in the Times model?
Paul Wheelhouse.
Well, certainly it's our intention to look at very closely at the recommendations of the committees in forming the final version of the report, and the Cabinet Secretary, I'll touch on later, will be leading that work, of course, and we'll look at what work is necessary to underpin that document. But I want to, and I will return to CCS later in my remarks, but, Presiding Officer, I want to focus for a while on energy. The continued evolution and transformation of the energy sector in Scotland is absolutely critical to the delivery of the draft climate change plan. Scotland currently stands on an impressive record where the energy sector is concerned. The equivalent of over half of Scotland's electricity consumption is now generated by renewable sources in Scotland. In 2015, in fact, the amount of electricity generated in Scotland by renewables equated to 59.4% of the gross annual consumption of electricity in Scotland, compared with 12.2% in 2000. And Mr. Carson, I think you indicated that we were missing targets, might want to note that fact. That was 9.4% beyond the 2015 target. Scottish companies and research institutions are now at the forefront of innovation in renewable energy technologies and services. We are a world-leading location for research, development and commercialisation of renewable energy, and Scotland's remote and island communities are already successfully demonstrating complex clean energy solutions, and we will continue to support these developments to extend the lessons learned across the whole of Scotland. But as we have acknowledged before, significant challenges lie ahead if we're to continue to make progress towards meeting our ambitious climate change targets and to maximise the social and economic benefits of our transition to a low-carbon economy. Achieving our ambitions will require the belief and commitment of the members of this Parliament, our energy industry partners and the people of Scotland. It will also require ingenuity and innovation to overcome constraints placed upon us by UK government policies. The draft energy strategy supports the delivery of a stable managed transition to a low-carbon economy, highlighting a range of technologies and fuels that will supply our energy needs over the coming decades. And this includes a landmark proposal for a new 2030 all-energy renewables target, setting an ambitious challenge to deliver the equivalent 50% of Scotland's energy requirements for heat, transport and electricity from renewable energy sources. We remain committed to the development of carbon capture and storage in Scotland, despite the current setbacks and UK government flip-flopping on policy and funding. And as we believe, as do international authorities, this is an example of a cost-effective way of meeting our emissions targets. The UK Committee on Climate Change also proposed CCS as an advanced way of reducing large-scale emissions, not only for the power sector, but for the industrial applications too. And Scotland is not only ideally placed to exploit renewables, it is also well-placed for CCS. Scotland has the existing pipeline infrastructure and CO2 storage capacity to support the development and deployment of commercial-scale CCS, but we must protect those pipelines from early decommissioning. Our draft energy strategy sets out a range of proposed new actions to support CCS in Scotland, including the application of bioenergy with CCS to reduce negative emissions as is set out in the draft plan. And we are keen to ensure that the final climate change plan is clear about the points at which major decisions about CCS and other key technologies need to be taken and the milestones at which we anticipate key staging points in the development of those technologies. In all our success in delivering clean energy supplies, we must acknowledge the role of the UK government. The direction of their approach has shifted significantly since 2015, and I would argue in a largely unhelpful direction. UK government policy changes towards renewables and carbon capture and storage have created a huge dent in investor confidence, which will be hard to regain, and the recent industrial strategy consultation was very light on energy measures. And Alexander Burnett may want to note, it appears the UK government is unable to commit to publishing its own emissions reduction plan, as rumours are now coming out from a Tory backbench MP that the plan might not appear until June, when originally it was due in 2016. Securing safe, secure and sustainable supplies of energy in Scotland is only one part of the challenge. Transforming the way energy is used will itself be fundamental to our approach. Our vision is that by 2050, through Scotland's energy efficiency programme, we will have transformed the energy efficiency and heating of our buildings so that where technically feasible and practical, buildings are near zero carbon, making our homes, shops, offices, schools and hospitals warmer and easier to heat, helping tackle fuel poverty and helping businesses to improve productivity and competitiveness. We're consulting on the finer details of this approach under the energy strategy and SEEP consultations. We also have an onshore wind policy statement out for consultation and district heating and local heat and energy efficiency plan consultations. There is a lot of detail underpinning the energy strategy, and we need to recognise that. And the responses to these consultations will be considered as we finalise both the energy strategy and ultimately the climate change plan as well. Securing the economic, environmental, social and commercial benefits of this new approach is a shared endeavour, Presiding Officer. Beyond the period of this parliamentary scrutiny of the draft climate change plan, we will continue with the ongoing and comprehensive consultation on the draft energy strategy, which closes on the 30th of May. There's much else I could say, Presiding Officer, but I know I've used up my time, but there are points around blue carbon, which we will be taking forward, and I point out to Conservative members, 83% of all the planting in forestry in 2015-16 was in Scotland. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
I now call Maurice Golden to close the debate on behalf of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee until just before 5 o'clock, please, Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is an honour to be closing this debate in my capacity as Deputy Convener of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. We have heard meaningful and helpful contributions on the third report on policies and proposals, the draft climate change plan, throughout the course of this debate. One central tenet heard across all speakers has been a commitment and a recognition that climate change must be tackled, and to do that and to lead the way in that process globally is going to mean taking some difficult and challenging decisions. I would like to cover three key areas of the draft plan: the scrutiny of the plan now and going forward, contribution from the waste sector, and contribution from the public sector. Before that, reflecting on the debate, Graeme Dey has highlighted the need for further clarification on pathways to deliver the climate change plan and outlined issues around the application of the Times model. The Cabinet Secretary highlighted previous success in this area and believed that the use of the Times model should be seen as a significant step forward, although referred to a steep learning curve on its use, but said we should persevere with this. The Cabinet Secretary also stated the emphasis on technological advancement was correct and summed up by concluding, we all need to work. We all need to work together to deliver it. A point I'm sure we can all agree on. Firstly, in the area of scrutiny, the committee welcomes the approach which brought together the expertise of four committees to critically enhance the draft plan and more generally supports the mainstreaming of climate change issues throughout the work of the Scottish Parliament. We have heard from each convener outlining their views. Gordon Lyndhurst, speaking on behalf of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee, covered transparency, timescale and behaviour change, and expressed a wish for more detail on budget and timelines before embarking somewhat tangentially on posing a question as to whether androids sleep or indeed dream. Bob Doris, speaking on behalf of the Local Government and Communities Committee, stated that we need to use the planning system to encourage climate change and highlighted concerns on how decarbonisation of heat will actually be achieved. Edward Mountain, speaking on behalf of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, outlined concerns in the assumptions and delivery of the agriculture, transport and forestry sectors. Overall, the Scottish Government's approach to developing the draft plan has differed from that used to create previous reports on policies and proposals. The consultation process involved hosting climate conversations with members of the public, sector-based workshops for stakeholders, as well as a stakeholder event on the draft plan as a whole. While the committee welcomes the intention to conduct a wide-ranging engagement process, the committee considers this was not executed sufficiently far in advance in order to inform the plan or give stakeholders confidence in the process. The committee expects the Scottish Government to engage further with stakeholders and seek advice from the Committee on Climate Change when finalising the plan. Information on this further engagement should be included in the plan. The committee believes the Scottish Government's approach on consulting on the draft energy strategy in tandem with the parliamentary scrutiny process of the draft climate change plan, whilst unavoidable, was unhelpful and did not afford Parliament the opportunity to consider fully developed proposals within the draft plan. The final plan should state explicitly how the results of the draft energy strategy consultation have contributed to the plan, and it should clarify the relationship between the plan and all other relevant national strategies. The committee plans to review the final climate change plan. It notes it has been Scottish Government practice to present the final plan prior to the summer recess of the parliamentary year. However, given the issues identified by the stakeholders and the various committees, it encourages the Scottish Government to prioritise consideration of matters raised by the scrutiny process over working to any deadline. The committee looks forward to scrutinising the forthcoming Climate Change Bill, which it hopes will extend the period available to the Scottish Parliament for consideration of future reports on policies and proposals. The committee also seeks a commitment from the Scottish Government that any relevant changes to climate change legislation are reflected in an updated plan. On the issue of waste, the committee supports the Scottish Government's commitment to explore how producer responsibility schemes can be made more effective. We recognise the extent of the contribution which must be made by the further development of the circular economy, and we recommend the final climate change plan include detailed information on the contribution of this to the policies and proposals in the waste sector. Given concerns raised by stakeholders about the challenges associated with meeting the target to end landfilling of biodegradable municipal waste by 2020, the committee recommends the Scottish Government provide further detail about the actions they are putting in place to achieve this, while ensuring that this does not result in an increase in this waste being treated in energy from waste facilities. Another major issue was the late timing of receipt of the clarification of how waste was included in the model, and this made it impossible for the committee to carry out scrutiny and to fully consider this in its report. The clarification also revealed the land use sector, in addition to agriculture, had been modelled externally. The committee considers receiving such significant briefings following the conclusion of its evidence taking to be very unhelpful. Furthermore, it believes that information on material importance to its consideration of the draft plan should have been contained in the plan itself. The committee strongly believes that all sectors should be considered consistently within the same model framework. The committee considers the public sector is vital to the successful delivery of the plan. However, it questions the current capacity and commitment of some public sector organisations. We consider that climate change leadership needs to be prioritised across the public sector and recommends the Scottish Government reflects on the calls for action to address barriers to climate change leadership in the public sector. Further information should be provided in the final climate change plan on the actions the government is taking to support strong leadership on climate change across the public sector. In closing, the committee recognises Scotland's ambitious and world-leading efforts in the quest to reduce carbon emissions and curtail the pace of climate change. The Climate Change Scotland Act 2009 was an innovative step in this process, and the committee is pleased to be working to achieve the aims of this groundbreaking legislation.
Thank you. That concludes our debate on the Environment Committee report. It's a debate on reports on draft climate change plan. We now move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Legislative Consent Motion 4445 in the name of Rosanna Cunningham on the Farriers Registration Bill. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary to move the motion.
Formally moved.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion 4534 in the name of Graeme Dey on reports on draft climate change plan, the draft third report on policies and proposals 2017-2032 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And the final question is that motion 4445 in the name of Rosanna Cunningham on the Farriers Registration Bill be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. And that concludes decision time. I close this meeting.